dispels myths, tackles the toughest topics, and makes no apologies for geeking out on beer. Hosted by two guys that drink before they think, Jamil Saint the Chef and John Palmer. This is Brew Strong.
Greetings, greetings.
I tell you, you know, having you here, Justin, it reminds me of the days, the good old days back in the garage.
The good old days, yeah.
Yes.
The days where I picked up some horrible disorder that is now killing me.
Something clearly happened to people in that Pacheco garage.
Yes.
JP's gotten the sickness.
Yes.
Tasty.
Yes.
You.
Yes.
I think me, but I don't really go to the doctor to find out for sure.
You don't really want to know until...
yeah, until it's too late.
I mean, you know, you die when you die, and the doctor probably isn't going to change that. I'm guessing what you have is not curable.
Probably so, which is why I don't bother going.
Right. There you go. It's makes perfect sense to me.
Just is what it is.
Hair loss happens to most of us, so don't worry.
Right. I haven't experienced that yet, but I do remember it wasn't quite a piece of advice from Jamil. It was like it was a warning of when
of impending doom.
Yeah, just when getting old is like really getting old, and
yes.
So I don't really have hair loss yet, and I don't have this other symptom yet either. But I remember you saying
the wiener still works.
The day you look down and the pubes are gray is when you really go. You said this to me, and you're like,
right,
that's
right.
When you really go, shit,
I'm
getting
old. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I'm just waiting for that ball to drop, so to speak.
I forgot about that. I'm full of solid advice.
Yeah, man.
No wonder this show was such a gem of the internet.
That's right.
Yeah. Justin and I were just talking about the loss of elasticity in our cradles here.
We were at the break, it's true.
You mean things are swinging low? the sweet chariot is going quite lower?
Our microphones we were talking about, really.
Yes,
sometimes
yeah.
The elasticity in them makes them sag a little.
Yeah, I don't know what you guys are talking about, but my balls really hang a whole lot lower than they did when I was younger.
Gravity always wins.
Things, you know, and here's the thing. People, you may not want to listen to this, but you know, like I'll be going to bed, and you know, I kind of like lift the sack up, and you know,
oh yeah,
so I'm not laying on top of them things,
so you don't hurt yourself.
Right?
Yeah, I've sat on it too, man.
Right? Yeah,
yeah.
You gotta pull them up, flop them up on top, and, you know,
awesome.
Prepare yourself for bed.
It's
a fact. Now, Bevo, I'm imagining your experience that maybe with other parts of your anatomy. You know,
right.
Maybe something you don't want to be rolling over and pinching one of those things off.
Yeah. The gender does not matter. Gravity just always wins.
Gravity eventually takes over. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's it's something that I seriously notice and that I experience every night now. I haven't had the giant avocado ball in a while, but I have had to pick them up and sling them around.
Right.
In preparation for sleeping. Yeah. Yeah.
Sounds like the least of your worries right now.
Well, it's still important to me.
Yeah. Right.
It's just from a comfort level. Yeah, old familiarity, good old friends.
Yeah.
They've been with me my whole life.
They have, for better or worse.
Well, right.
Yeah.
And just like I feel John Blickman has been with me my whole life.
Yeah.
For better
yes.
or worse, he's been there. He's been our sponsor. Just one of the best sponsors you're ever going to have because no matter how crappy this show is, no matter what, he's in there. He's cutting the check. He's paying for the show so you don't have to. Great guy. Brilliant, brilliant engineer.
Yeah.
And just one of the sweetest people I know. And making great stuff. Stuff that will improve your brew day, will make your brew day more fun, more productive, more consistent, more reliable. And he's now doing it for the pro level as well. He's taken his genius and he's applying it in his manufacturing knowledge and making pro level equipment that if you want to go pro, he's got it for you.
He's got 5-barrel turnkey systems that work really well.
Right. And if for some reason not, I guarantee you he's going to make it right. You know, that's you can back it up with a, you know, John Blickman guarantee. I'll personally guarantee it myself. You know, if you decide to go with Blickman, you know, you're in safe hands. And if you know, if you're not looking for the five-barrel pro system, if you're not looking for all the bells and whistles, and you're just looking for, you know, solid, great, you know, brewing equipment, there's a whole Anvil line. He's got it covered from Anvil to Z, whatever that would be.
Anvil to Blickman to Pro.
There you go. A to B to P. He's got to have a Z line. I'm just thinking this is an opportunity for me to get in with Blickman.
There you go.
And then we can have it from A to Z.
I didn't think of that. That's good.
There you go. All right. That's a gem that you can turn into tens of dollars.
Yeah, yeah.
Thinking,
if you make it to another Homebrew Con, maybe we'll see that by next year.
Well, we'll see. Yeah. I was there. I was literally there.
Right.
In Providence, in my hotel room.
Days before the rest of us.
Yeah,
early.
I was there. I was so excited.
Yeah.
I was really looking forward to it. And my darn wife.
Yeah.
And she's alive still.
At least that's good. It wasn't a waste.
Hell yeah.
You know.
She had to have emergency surgery. She had some ovary cyst twisted.
Oh, man.
The thing is, it's like your testicles.
Okay.
Right. And when one of them gets twisted, testicular torsion, it starts filling up with blood, starts swelling up.
Yikes.
And it can be a real problem. It could kill you. And same thing happened to her, and they started filling up with blood. The blood goes in, but it can't get back out.
Okay.
And so one of these cysts was the size of a basketball, and one was the size of a softball.
Damn. Oh, goodness sake.
So but the good thing is they got it out.
Yeah.
And, you know, almost immediately.
Okay.
You know, she's better.
I see.
So she's back to work, working
she's
her ass
fine,
off
huh?
like she usually is.
You guys both do that. Yeah. You both just you work your asses off.
And more her than me. I appreciate you throwing me in there in the bunch.
I think you both do. I wonder when you guys are going to take a break. Isn't it time for a break yet?
It was time for a break years ago.
Yeah.
It was. But
you're too cheap. You won't hire. You won't replace yourself. Is the problem is.
I'd be so happy to replace myself.
Yeah.
One, I wouldn't have, you know, this idiot working for me anymore. I have some other idiot working for me.
You're right.
But two, yeah, it's just, you know.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad she's okay.
Yes.
I was worried when you said you had to leave real quick. I was worried about Liz, so.
Yeah, I got out of the shower. I got her text. I got in contact with the United, which was lovely.
Really?
And actually even refunded me $218.
Well, that never happens. Wow.
Didn't charge me to change my flight.
Really?
Yeah. And flew me back, got me home. I was home by around midnight.
Wow. That's really great.
Well, finding out 10 o'clock in the morning in Providence.
Yeah.
And then getting me to Sacramento at midnight. That's pretty damn, you know, with no notice.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of weather cancellations and stuff over there.
Wow.
That's just brilliant.
You don't hear those success stories very often.
It did cost me $120 to take a cab from Providence to to Logan.
Okay,
but,
yeah.
But, you know, they got me on a flight, and it was well worth it.
Worth every penny.
Yeah, yeah. And Liz is alive. So
there we go. That's what matters.
Well, there's certain things that matter. It's fairly important to me.
Yeah.
She's in the top 10.
I'd have to make that list, but yeah, I imagine so. Speaking of which, we are going to be going over John and I's must-have top 10 list of
brewing equipment
for brewing beer in your brewery. I mean, have I explained it enough?
It's pretty good.
I think so.
Right. Well, and I guess John's going to tackle the homebrew side. I'm going to tackle the pro side, and we'll see what we come up with. I don't know. It could be very interesting.
I like it. I think people like these sorts of things from those that they respect. You know, like Palmer. they want to hear, like, what is, you know, what's your top 10 things you can't
beer on your console here.
Top 10 things you can't do without. You know, I think over the years you guys have had enough experience that you whittle down that. You've probably been through some equipment that you thought you needed, and now you're like, I don't even touch that anymore.
Absolutely.
So.
Well, and when doing this list, you know, I was like, you know, I could brew without hardly anything. Mm. You know, put me naked on an island.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, besides that, you put me in a situation where there's no brewing equipment.
Right.
And I'll brew some beer. Yeah. One way or another, I'm making alcohol.
Yeah.
And we're drinking.
Right. Yeah.
One way or another, I can make it work. So I don't think you need, in a way, any equipment. Mm-hmm. I think you take somebody like John Blickman. And you strand him on a desert island, he's going to find some washed up crap and he's going to put together stuff and start making, he'd probably make methamphetamine.
Right.
And, you know, just be out of his gourd.
Yeah.
But the rest of us would probably do
he'd
beer.
Be the professor on Gilligan's Island.
Yeah. Yeah. But more fun.
Right. And with more meth.
Yeah, exactly.
He would definitely be making meth.
Yeah. So that may be so, Jay-Z, that, you know, as you become an experienced brewer, you can do without a lot of things. But I still think that this list is like how you guys optimize your and make the best thing you can easily.
Well, that's the whole thing. And why I'm such a fan of, like, Blickman's stuff is because it's improving your brew day. It's removing some of the restrictions, the complexities, the difficulty. It's like surviving on a desert island.
Yeah.
You end up, you know, struggling to get food versus going to the grocery store or the refrigerator, or cooking on a stove. You have to, like, light a fire with a, you know, couple of sticks. And, you know, it's just very difficult. Why should brewing be that way?
Mm-hmm.
You know, spend a little bit of money, you know, get the things that are important. You know, don't waste money, because, you know, look at some of these things that we're going to talk about and implement them in your brewery, in your brew day. Your brewing's going to get better. It's going to get easier, more consistent. And when you have that, I think you make better beer because you've, you know, eliminated a lot of problems. It's like you cook better food when you have the tools to do it and the ingredients to do it.
Sure.
So there you go.
I like it.
Let's take a short break. And when we come back, we'll get into John's top 10. Right after this.
Thank you.
the two guys that know how to turn beer into beer. This is Brew Strong.
All right, we're back. All right.
All right.
Top 10 things, pieces of equipment you cannot do without, John, in your brewing. Let's start with, I mean, do we need drum rolls? Do we need David Letterman saying these things? What would be number 10?
Number 10, a pump.
A pump.
Yep.
Now see, the interesting thing about doing this in reverse is,
important, you know, but kind of the least important in the grand scheme of things.
Right, because you could use gravity instead of a pump. What kind of pump would you use? The Blickman has those
Riptide pumps.
The Riptide pumps. I tell you, just genius on the maybe it sounds like a Blickman commercial, but you know, when we're talking about equipment, I'm always amazed at the, you know, the innovations that guy does.
Oh yeah, I mean,
not that I get paid anything from easy by promoting it, but. Yeah. I really do. You know, he took like the standard pump and put, you know, just genius stuff on it. I'm always amazed, just amazed. So, yeah, Blickman's not blowing me or anything. I'm just saying. I'm always surprised.
Yeah. Well, but yeah, a pump is a great piece of equipment.
Especially when it blows me. That's really when I'm surprised.
That's even better. Wow.
All right. Right. Pump, very useful for things like if you want to do a whirlpool chilling, if you want to transfer, you know, here to there, versus relying on gravity all the time, which can be a real pain in the ass.
You know, sometimes blockage occurs and you have more resistance than the line that you figured, and hey, a pump can push it through. So,
right.
Yeah, pump, all very right. useful piece of equipment.
When you have blockage, when blockage occurs, pump
right.
it. Did you hear that, Justin? When you have blockage, you want to pump it.
You want to pump it.
Okay.
Got it. Making notes.
Right. I think squeezing hard and pulling a little more will sometimes clear the blockage.
Get the blockage.
You need to clamp down on the hose, squeeze, and pull.
Okay.
Well, what's your number 10, Jamel?
Oh, no. We're going back and forth?
We can do it either way.
Yeah. Why not?
What do you mean, why not?
Why not?
Oh, Jesus Christ, Justin.
You weren't ready?
I wasn't ready. Throw me. Well, and this will again sound like an ad for Blickman, but I had a Blickman beer gun. On the pro side, a Blickman beer gun.
That's your number 10.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's not critical, but when you want to, you know, submit things to a competition, or when you want to, you know, send something out for lab analysis, we have our full lab. But we also send out samples to other labs to confirm what we're doing as well.
Hmm.
We don't do it, you know, every thing we do, but, you know, maybe a couple times a year we will send samples out to other labs to verify what we're doing. It's just a double check. And, you know, having the beer gun, you know, you can get a 0 parts per billion fill on a bottle with a Blickman beer gun. It takes a long time. But it's one of the only ways you can do it. And you can just flood that thing and then fill it up. And, so for competitions, things like that, it's, you know, it's cheap relatively in the pro world. And really
effective and easy.
Effective, easy to use.
I think I've told this before.
Oh, and?
Yeah.
Interrupt your idea.
That's okay.
Because I'll forget mine.
Yeah.
Otherwise.
Right. Go ahead.
And we do on Evil 3 Day, we actually fill growlers from the directly from the fermenter, and we use Blickman beer guns for that.
I knew I had seen one in your brewery in the back, like, not up at the tap room, and I was
like
trying
five.
To remember what that was for, and it was, give people work. Even.
Right. Evil 3 Day, we'll fill growlers directly from the fermenter, and the beer guns are one of the only ways you can do that. You can't just, like, you know, just walk up to the fermenter and crack open the valve and spit it into a growler. That'd be screwed.
Keep it nice and clean.
Yeah. So Blickman Beer Gun. Yeah. Actually, see, now that I thought about that, I may have moved it up the line. But
well, and I just wanted to say quickly, because I don't remember what state it was, either Tennessee or Texas, where they're allowed to, from a bar, they're allowed to sell that and sell growlers. So you don't have to be a brewer. You could just be a tap room and sell growlers.
Right. Oregon, a bunch of.
And gosh, maybe it was even Oregon. I don't. But I went into this bar, and instead of having 20 taps,
20 Blickman beer guns.
They had 20 Blickman beer guns.
It's in Oregon, I want to say.
Okay.
I think it's in Oregon.
You might be right. Okay. Yeah, yeah.
And they had the they had like carboys for chandeliers or something.
Yeah.
And
even if you went in to order a pint, they would fill the pint from the Blickman beer gun.
Right.
But mostly they were doing a lot of growlers to go.
Right.
So rather than have one little station, they just made every single tap,
yeah.
I thought it was great.
I did too. I thought it was brilliant.
Cool idea.
It was really cool, yeah. So there you go. Maybe that should have been number one.
We'll see.
Okay. John, you're number nine.
The Auto Siphon and similar products thereof.
Mm-hmm.
Just saw a really interesting one at the past Homebrew Con. They had a stainless steel silicone auto siphon type product company was selling.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, you know, compared to trying to suck on a piece of hose to get a siphon going, the auto siphon just...
Depends how well you know how to suck.
Well, yeah, but and where your mouth's been.
Right.
You know? But, yeah, it just, you know, prevents a lot of contamination, a lot of, bottle bombs and strange fermentation.
Well, see, here's where I gotta disagree with you on this one, because I always hated any auto siphon. And maybe it was because when I started, the auto siphons that were available were pieces of crap. They never started the siphon. I could never get them to work. And so I always went with just a piece of hose, you know?
That's how you pump it, man.
That's right. It's how you suck it. Snap myself off a fresh piece of hose. And I'd start with like a turkey baster or whatever. And I never had any problems with that. But the auto siphon, I always struggled with it. And maybe it's because I'm very limited and very special. That could be it.
To each his own.
Right. Yeah. Well, you know, that's brewing. Everybody's got his own way of doing it. It's one of the cool things about collabs. We got a little time. I did a collab with some friends of mine in Birmingham, England, called Burning Soul Brewing. And just the greatest guys in the world. I love these guys, Chris and Rich. And why am I talking about this? Because, you know, everybody's got a different way of brewing. And every time you go and do a collab, you learn something or you see something, a different way that somebody else is doing it. And they're doing it successfully. Burning Soul, I have tasted every single one of the beers, not like special samples that they were giving me. It's just like, pull it off the tap while we're brewing, and just freaking perfect and delicious. And you know the reason is because they know what they're doing with their kit. Now, if I had to brew on that kit, it's not the greatest equipment in the world, but you know they're making world class beer off of what they got. And I can tell you this story, right? I got time. Who's going to worry about this? Nobody listens to the show anyways. We made an Imperial Milk Stout, 650 liters of wort, and we dissolved 50 kilograms of marshmallows into the wort.
Wow.
Yes. It was 20% of the grist by weight. You know, a marshmallow doesn't weigh much. It's 70% air. By weight, it was 20% of the grist.
Wow.
And when you throw, I have not done this on this scale before. I meant to brew it on large scale, but when you throw some marshmallows into wort, you don't really realize because it's, what do you throw in? Like a handful, a bag? Big deal. 50 kilos. When you put a marshmallow into boiling wort, it's going to it's 70% air, and that 70% of air is like a boil, mini boil over going to happen every time you throw one in. And so we're trying to the 50 kilos of marshmallows was bigger than the kettle we were using, but we got them all to dissolve in there. It took just we were constantly throwing them in, and it was the most amazing thing. The whole thing started turning quite viscous. And marshmallows are made up of vanilla flavoring, glucose, dextrose, and gelatin.
Hmm.
There's quite a bit of gelatin in those things.
Okay.
And gelatin is a fining agent. We use it here in the U.S. all the time, and it'll pull yeast out like you wouldn't believe. And so I started panicking a little bit. I'm like, well, wait a minute. I wonder if the gelatin is going to take the yeast out of suspension, keep this thing from fermenting.
Mm, yeah.
I was like, oh my God, I've screwed these guys up on this really expensive beer. And but then I'm like, well, the gelatin will coagulate and it should drop to the bottom and it shouldn't really cause a problem. But then on the other hand, I mean, maybe it stays in, enough stays in suspension. Maybe the whole thing turns into like a solid mass once it cools down.
Right.
So it was a lot of fun.
But it worked. It did. None of that happened.
Everything worked out just fine.
Okay.
You can put 50 kilograms of marshmallows. That's about all that will dissolve into 650 liters of wort.
And did it clarify? Was it a clear beer because of the gelatin, though? Or was it a hazy? Or
I think it should be clear.
Okay. Oh, you don't know yet. Yeah.
Yeah, I wasn't, they started fermenting and I had left. I
right.
met up with them at GBBF, Great British Beer Festival, after that. But I'll tell you, if you get a chance to be around Birmingham, go by Burning Soul. Just two of the nicest people you're going to meet in brewing, and really talented brewers and creative people, and a lot of fun to hang out with.
Hmm.
I just love those guys.
Not the smartest guys ever working with you in the marshmallows, but nice guys.
A little bit of a dumbass, especially that Chris guy. I mean, really. I don't know. I don't know if you heard the story about Nando's and when he killed two people.
Oh, dear.
But, Chris.
Sounds like my life. What's your number nine, Jay-Z?
My number nine is, you're trying to get me back on track.
A little
bit.
See
what you did there.
Just a little.
A hop freezer.
Oh, right.
Because, when you open these bags, you don't always work in 44-pound increments or 20-kilo increments. You you have some left over. And one of the things, the colder the temperature, the better your hops are going to store. So we store the bulk of our hops in our big walk-in, and it's like 37 degrees Fahrenheit. But once the bags open, no longer nitrogen flushed, we roll them up and we put them in the hop freezer. And they get used within a few days, but I think that that little extra bit of temperature control, dropping it down to, whatever it is, minus 10 or 4 or whatever it is, really helps. So just a good giant chest freezer.
Okay.
It's right next to the brew platform. It's real convenient.
So when the hops come in and they're sealed from the supplier, fridge is fine.
Yeah.
It's only after you open them you go to the freezer.
Yes.
Okay.
And I think that makes a difference. I do.
All right.
So, hop freezer, number nine. John, you're number eight.
Quick disconnects.
Oh, yeah.
The there have been many, many connection options, available for years. But for me, the Moore Beer stainless steel QDs, I have always been my gold standard.
Mm-hmm.
And I've had, I'm a do-it-yourselfer. I've made several different brew systems, practically brew on a new system every time I brew.
Mm-hmm.
And
because your beer ruins the previous one.
You'd think. But I just get a better idea. And,
right.
Or at least I think I do. But having, these quick disconnects on the ends of every hose, the male ends, and then the females on the kettles or the fermenters or the pumps. It just means you can snap a hose in,
right.
Swap hoses out, move them around real easy, very convenient.
Right. You can couple up wherever you want to couple your hose.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm with you 100%. I think that, there's a lot of times, especially if you're going to use a pump, where you can move things around, you can change your configuration on the fly, and it's extremely useful. In the commercial brewing world, we use mainly tri-cover clamps, sanitary clamps. They're not as quick to use, but it generally gives you the same
that
sort
flexibility.
Of result.
Yeah,
and it's very important. And I mean to think of it, I don't know that we could brew in the commercial world without tri-clamps. I consider that one of the basic requirements.
The given, yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
But I like it on a homebrew list. I didn't have QDs until I got your brew system, Jamil.
Oh, yeah.
And then I understood the value and the ease of them. So.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's fantastic. For me, number eight is a good set of accurate measuring tools for volume. So, like 10, 100,000 mil, accurate graduated cylinders. So that when you're measuring out things, I mean, we use a lot of pipettes as well and pipetters, especially when we're testing things like, how much fruit do we want to add to this beer? And, being able to accurately measure volume is, really, really critical. And I guess in the homebrew world, I would put, maybe a scale, a good, accurate, gram scale or something like that.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Quite handy, and like I've said in the past, if it's a scale, is good for measuring cocaine. It's good for measuring hops.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that's a great one, Jamil, because you are a man who has built his reputation on side by side testing, and all the recipes that you did in brewing classic styles, perfecting your beers over time. I mean, you did that based on consistency of measurement, changing one variable at a time. And I agree. When I've done my experiments and for the books, you got to have a calibrated, reliable means of measuring things, whether it's volume or weight. Yeah, so very, very good point.
There you go. All right. Let's see here. Number seven for you, John.
Ball valves that you can mount on the side of a kettle or fermenter.
Right.
Just, negates the need for an auto siphon. But again, very, very easy things to keep clean.
The auto siphon's really handy in things like transferring from a fermenter. You may not have ball valves available like on a glass fermenter or something like that.
Right.
Yeah. Well, and for number seven for me, I went again with measurement. Actually, I do have 11 on my list now.
Oh, yeah. He just goes to 11.
Number seven, I'd be, quality set of narrow range hydrometers. And quality hydrometer jar cylinder. So, the one hydrometer you get that goes from zero to a million. It's just not as precise, and really when you're doing professional brewing, having a set of narrow range hydrometers, which means you get one from zero to 10-32, you'll get one from 10-20 something to 10-50 something, and so it's a narrower range, so the marks are more spread out.
I see.
Your bulb is much larger and much more generous, shall we say?
Mm-hmm.
And then a good hydrometer jar, a clear one that's the right size and volume. Those things really help to be able to precisely measure what's going on. And especially if you're watching fermentation and you want to know where your gravities are, and you should be checking that every day. To observe the progress of your fermentations, I think is a critical set of tools.
I see. Now, that one might seem obvious to you, Jay-Z, but I never knew that existed, and I always thought that reading a hydrometer was kind of a pain in the ass with the marks too close together.
Right. Because
I knew I was never. I was like, right. Maybe it's 10.8, maybe it's 10.6. Right. I don't know.
Yeah.
I did not know that they made a more easier to read more accurate device.
And they'll, I mean, they'll even certify them. They come with certification papers that they're adjusted correctly, and you know they're reading precise.
Okay.
It's you actually legally have to have it for a distillery.
I see.
You don't legally have to have it for a brewery. So there you go.
That's a good one.
Why? Thank you. I'm pleased with that one. All right. Let's do this. You want to take a short break, and when we come back, we'll resume with John's number six.
Number six. Yeah. Coming up.
All right. Right after this.
To brew has never been so disgusting. This is Brew Strong.
All right, we're back. We're doing our top 10 list of the homebrew and professional brew equipment that we can't live without. I guess, you know, you think about all the pieces and parts that you have in your homebrew arsenal and your pro arsenal. I mean, you've got like a little, you know, white totes of 50
hoses,
different pieces of things, hoses, yeah, little devices. And the weird thing is, and I wanted to do a blog or something called The Critical Brick.
Mm-hmm.
And this is from my friends at Malmo Brewing, Tom Svensson, and the great brewers there. But pretty sure it was their brewery. Yeah. And this is where I started thinking about it is like when they ran this hose into, you know, some part of the brewing process, they take this brick and put it over the top of the hose. And without the brick, every brewery I've been to, there's like a brick or there's a binder clip or there's a piece of wire or there's, you know, a stick or there's some piece of something that without it, they couldn't brew. And so I was like, and they're like, well, yeah, the brick's critical. I'm like, yeah, it's your critical brick.
Right.
And I'm like, every brewery has this. And so I just thought that someday I'd wander around and I would find the critical brick at every brewery.
Right.
And for a while there, I was asking everybody, what's the critical brick? And they'd be like, what? I'm like, you know, what?
Until you explain.
Of piece of crap. And they're like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Every brewery has it.
Yeah.
Every brewery has a critical brick. And every home brewer has it. I remember my good friend Dave Sapsis. His was like a binder clip and a piece of wire, you know, without which he couldn't brew, you know?
Yeah.
And the weird thing is, you know, to find another brick of the right weight and size and shape, you know, is very difficult. You can't just go out and buy these things.
Right.
That's why they're critical. All right. So the critical brick should be on here.
I think so.
There you go.
It's your number 12.
That's my number 12 is my critical brick.
Should be on John's number 6.
Number 6, yes.
Yeah, and it is. It is the kettle tube screen.
Oh, yeah.
And I've labored over kettle, you know, hop screens and things for years, and finally built my own out of the that stainless steel mesh you get off of the
braided hose.
Yeah, braided hose,
reinforced hose,
washing machine hose.
Right.
And that really did the trick for me. That solved all my blockage problems going into the pump, going into the chiller.
All your blockage problems. Freed up. You hear that, Justin?
Yeah, I do. Yeah.
Solve your blockage problems.
And to me, correct me if I'm wrong, guys, but that's one that over the years, it seems like almost everyone has tried to just create a off-the-shelf device. But
right.
There's no one size fits all. I'm guessing that's why you had to end up making your own, John. Like we've had sponsors give me some before, and just you know, they never quite worked in everybody's system.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I the one I made for me, you know, fit over the end of the dip tube on my Blickman kettles, and so that became the Anvil kettle screen that we sell.
Okay.
Yeah, but it, you know, yeah, you need something that you know stays on and screens the tube to keep you from you know standing there going, well, shit, how do I get it in the fermenter now?
Yeah,
and you know, reaching for a piece of hose.
Okay.
So yeah, it's one of those things. It's that critical brick where you know if you realize you don't have that, it kind of stops your brew day.
There you go. For me, number 6 was the ability to check the CO2 levels in a beer, because you know on the smaller scale, it's easy enough to weigh and to use time and temperature and a chart, and you know what the CO2 level is on something. But on the larger scale, when you're trying to you know carbonate 120 barrels of beer, you really need to know what's coming out. And I got some friends with smaller breweries, and they you know don't have the ability to check, and sometimes their CO2 levels can be quite variable on some beers. And I think that you know being able to check CO2 levels is you know carbonation levels in your beer is quite a joy and a necessity in the commercial brewery.
That's interesting, because you don't have that issue really at the homebrew level unless you're trying to win competitions. But you know, I mean, you got the
even
you've
then
got
it's
the
like a point, you know.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you, in the homebrew level, you see it on your regulator. You know, you got it set to 10, 15 psi, something like that.
Right.
But yeah, I can see where you know you don't have
well, and those things tend to be wrong too.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, really on the homebrew scale, I've never really cared what my carbonation level was, as long as it was carbonated.
You've always been quite gassy, though, John.
Yes, that is true.
Yeah. All right, number 5 on your list?
Oh, the wort chiller in all its glory, whether it's immersion, counterflow, plate, pretty critical. Now we're getting the top 5. That's pretty critical piece of equipment.
I'm almost surprised that, you know, it isn't even higher.
But I kind of wondered that too.
There's ways to get around it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could just seal it up and let it chill overnight.
Right, like our friends in Australia do.
Yeah.
The no chill. Yeah. Okay. What kind of chiller do you like? You haven't specified.
You know, I've been using the Blickman Therminator for years. Mm-hmm. The plate chillers have the advantage of compact size, quick chilling, you know, good efficiency there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. One I used before that was my 50-foot immersion chiller, which always worked every time, you know, very little hassle, easy to clean.
Right.
So,
you can clean the exterior of it, which is nice.
I never had great luck with immersion chillers and tending to brew in the summer where, like, even the water mm-hmm. wasn't all that cold. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until Tasty talked me into using the Therminator mm-hmm. that I was really able to get my wort down to almost pitching temp, like really close to pitching temp, mm-hmm. quickly enough. Right. I just never had a lot of luck with an immersion one.
Right.
And of course, we should just mention, everyone was so worried about how you can't properly clean a plate chiller. But, you know, Tasty's method was just, well, clean it immediately afterward when you're done. Mm-hmm. Run water both directions through it. And he makes great beer and never had an issue.
I will guarantee you that you can't clean the interior of a plate chiller without taking it apart.
Okay.
I mean, that's one thing every 6 months, every year, we have to take our plate chiller apart.
I see, yeah.
And clean it out. And you'd be surprised at how much builds up in there.
You don't think that even, like, on a homebrew scale, as long as you're immediately flushing it like Tasty's method was, you still think you're going to get some buildup in there?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
But, you know, as long as you're heat sanitizing it, the only real problem you're running into, I mean, you've got to heat the things up to kill off whatever's in there, because it will build up material in there. The only thing you're running into is at some point your flow is becoming more and more restricted, and you will see a reduction in chilling performance, and you'll see a reduction in flow. You'll have to put more pressure on it. One of John's items was a pump in order to push harder against something.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
But, you know, on the homebrew scale, you know, something like the Therminator is probably going to last you the rest of your brewing life. You'd have to run an insane number of brews through there before this is a problem. As long as you're cleaning
this
it,
this is what
know,
I was
right
thinking.
After,
yeah,
you're going to die before it becomes a problem.
Yeah,
I mean, you in particular.
In particular, yeah.
But it takes a lot of. So we're brewing, you know, days a week.
Yeah,
and you know. So our plate chiller, you know, is seeing, you know, a lot more volume going through it. It's larger, but, you know, on the homebrew scale, how many batches are you brewing a year? If you're brewing 30 or 50 even, which most people
are
never
not,
do,
yeah.
If you're brewing once a week, it's going to be 20 years of that before it's a problem even. And it may not even, it may be, you know, 30 years.
Sure.
So it's not a big deal. It is impossible to clean it by circulating liquid through it.
Okay.
It works, but it's not perfect.
Okay.
That's all I want people to know. So, but I think it's not a problem also on the other hand.
As long as you heat sanitize before you use it the next time.
I think heat sanitizing is a brilliant idea on the end.
Yeah.
You'll never run into a problem if you do that.
Yeah, just throw it in the oven 250, 300 degrees for half an hour. And
or even just, you know, circulate some boiling liquid through it until the thing gets hot, and you're good.
That's what I did.
All right. My number five is a precision thermometer for checking your other thermometers.
Ah. Good. Yeah.
Because, you know, and I would throw a pressure gauge in there, too, because if you cannot check, if you cannot rely on the instruments that you get, you can get, you know, some certified ones. We've got a specialized device that actually checks the pressure of the pressure gauges. Because without it, they're all over the place. They get bumped, or they just come in 3 PSI off. And, you know, if you're trying to carbonate and, you know, you're relying on the pressure gauge on your CO2 tank and the temperature of your thermometer in your fridge, if those things aren't precise, you could be off like half a volume. So that's why sometimes I think people struggle with, it isn't carbonated right. You know, forced carbonation doesn't work. Well, I don't even, you can't even do truly precise, bottle carbonation without really knowing the temperature of the beer and really knowing, the dissolved CO2 that's already in there and, being able to weigh out precisely your amount of sugar, right?
Yep.
There you go. So a lot of mine's based on measurement, I think. I mean, that's an important part to me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. John, you're number four.
Four. Let's see. Yeah, this is where the chiller and number four could swap places. Mm-hmm. Number four for me is a bottle of spray sanitizer.
Okay.
A spray bottle of sanitizer.
I'm wondering, are you saying you don't need sanitizer? Or...
No, I'm saying that it is a spray bottle of sanitizer.
So you would still use sanitizer. You're saying that your device is, your number four is a spray bottle.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. It's a spray bottle.
Yeah.
Not spray sanitizer.
Of sanitizer. No. Yeah.
Specifically for sanitizer.
You could spray anything out of that thing, John.
Well, yeah. I could spray yeast out of it, I guess. But
right.
Everybody likes spraying things.
Yeah, this is a good one. It's, you know, there's just sometimes nooks and crannies you can't get to without a spray. You're not going to dip everything in a bucket.
Well, yeah. And even if you do, when you dip something, you can have air bubbles form.
Hmm.
It'll form like a little, meniscus of air on a surface, and that is not getting sanitized.
Yeah.
It's one of the advantages of a spray bottle is you can get that fine mist or you can get, a stream or whatever you need. Whatever you need mm-hmm. shooting out of that bottle, you can
move it down. Yeah.
Adjustable.
Yeah.
I'm assuming John wants adjustable. And then you can spray that on, and it actually does a better job of coating the surface than if it was dipped into a bucket.
Mm-hmm.
Because, again, some sort of structure, fitting, whatever.
Hydrophobicity. Yeah.
Right. Can.
That was probably.
Exactly. That's the word I was looking for. Trap air, just like, like beetles when they go underwater, they trap air with them. That's not getting sanitized.
Mm-hmm.
So the spray bottle is actually a useful tool with the sanitizer, as John's saying, to a little bit better sanitizing there.
I like it when low tech becomes high tech like that,
Right. Well, there's a reason for it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Something so simple, you don't really think about, the effect it's having.
Yeah.
But can be important. All right.
What's your number four?
Number four, pH meter.
Oh, yes. Very good.
I mean, really, so what we use it for is, not only the mash, not only our water. Of course, we use the Lamont kit for, checking our water, and then the mash, and then also for daily, every fermentation, we are checking the pH of the fermentation. Because just like specific gravity, pH follows a certain path during your fermentation. And one of the things that you want to do, especially as a pro brewer, and I think as a home brewer if you can, is to check your specific gravity and your pH every day. And if you plot that out and, your beer turns out great, plot that same thing every time. If you check other fermentations, if you see that there's a deviation on pH or gravity day to day, then there's a problem. You've done something different. There's an issue with that ferment, and you need to take action, or you need to at least be aware that beer may not work out. So, it's critical to be able to check your pH of a fermentation daily.
A little bit of an off on a tangent here, but mm-hmm. Do you do pH measurement beginning and end of mash?
Mm.
Or just once during?
We do a pH beginning of the mash, and we do a pH of the runnings. Okay. Or the and like a kettle pH as well.
So you do kettle full. Okay.
Right.
Which would be essentially end of mash.
I've made them record so much data. They get annoyed with me, but yeah, our log, you see a lot of breweries log sheets, mm-hmm. and they've got maybe 10 lines of them or whatever. Ours is just packed. I'm just like, no, I need every little bit of data, because that's the only way you're actually going to be able to affect things. Maybe log sheet should be number one.
There you go.
All right.
Well, the reason I ask is because at the last Homebrew Con, I did my water talk, and I have a graphic where I show the decrease in pH throughout the brewing process from the mash down to, to the end of mash, to the boil, to the fermentation, to final beer pH. And I show it as a continual decrease.
Right.
Well, Martin Brunegard said that in his experience that pH tends to rise during the mash. And that just seemed wrong to me, in my experience. And so I was just wondering if, in your experience.
I think we're getting final runnings pH. It does tend to rise. It depends on what your water is.
Yeah, that's my thought.
If you're fly sparging or not, or are you talking about just the mash rest?
I think just the mash rest was he was referring to. I mean, because I think we would agree that as you sparge, as you louder,
right,
the pH will rise.
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
But he was saying just during the mash itself.
I would imagine that is a possibility with, the enzymatic activity going on, the conversion to the sugars. It may be releasing some, or it may be utilizing...
just changing the buffer compounds.
Yeah, and so the buffering is being consumed, and that may be a possibility as well.
Yeah, I think if you have insufficient calcium in the mash, then that may be a factor.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you have sufficient calcium, you're still going to get calcium reacting with phosphates, generating protons, and general decrease.
Isn't there generally enough calcium in the malt? I guess it depends on where it's grown.
Yeah.
Right.
Depends on it's grown, depends on what the alkalinity of the water is
that it's
working against. Because you've got so much phosphate in the malt itself that has a particular KI.
Right. There's a considerable amount.
Yeah.
So
anyway, I didn't want to go off on too much of a tangent, but
I think that's fascinating. That's what people listen to this load of a show for, is us just wandering off on
dispensing loads.
It's dispensing loads left and right. part of it might be it depends on where you're brewing and, what the water is and what kind of malt you tend to use. And if you're using German Pilsner malt all the time with really soft water and you're making, some sort of, Pilsner all the time, you may experience that versus you're making, Irish dry stout with, or Burton water or something like that. You're going to experience a whole different world of, pH change in the mash.
Yeah, I think that's the case. Right.
I think the important thing is to have the tools to measure it. And, when the beer tastes right, it's like, okay, so those are the numbers we want. Those numbers aren't present, and that's right. Problem. All right. Let's see. What was my – so that was your number four?
That was your number four,
pH meter. Right. So John's number three.
A good boil kettle.
Okay.
Instead of a crappy one?
Yeah, one that is durable, doesn't dent easy, doesn't corrode easy, transfers heat well, doesn't
scorch. An anvil brewing.
Yeah, kind of like an animal brew. You know, but I mean, yeah, there's lots of possibilities for good kettles out there these days. I mean,
right.
When I started, I was using the the canning pot, the black enameled canning
me too.
Pot.
Me too.
Yeah.
I had one with a chip in it that was rusted.
Yeah. Everybody has one of those, I think, with that one rusty chip.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, well, you know, I don't taste rust.
Yeah.
It must be fine.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. And
you're number three.
Well, I would also, on John's kettle, the brew plant, the equipment that you're using, if you cannot get a good boil, I would, on the pro level, the burner and all that stuff, or how you're heating the kettle, is integrated into the kettle. You don't buy a kettle and set it on a separate burner. You know, you are steam jacketed, and then you have your boiler, or you've got direct fire. So it's actually really critical.
Mm-hmm.
And a good kettle, if you cannot get a boil, you don't have to boil as vigorously as people think. But having a kettle that is easy to clean, a kettle that holds the right amount of wort. A kettle that'll come to a boil at times, fairly quickly. That's all very important in a commercial brewery as well. So, kettle's a pretty good item.
And on the homebrew side, just looking at Palmer's list, by the way, with a good kettle, you can knock out a couple of the things on Palmer's top 10 list, including ball valves and quick disconnects, opposed to a kettle that doesn't have valves at all, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
A good kettle, I think Palmer is saying, might even include a couple other things on his list.
Right. That's excellent point there. I'm surprised. You're actually paying attention.
Every now and then.
Right. You're drinking just the right amount at this point.
Yeah.
My number three was an O2 meter.
Yes, very good.
It's important for consistently being able to. Well, there's two kinds of O2 meters for the brewery. There's one for your wort oxygenation, and there's one for your package oxygen. And if you're a small brewery that's doing mainly draft, and you're doing out of your tap room, you don't need the package oxygen. It's not as important as the wort oxygen. So I would go with the wort oxygen as being the more critical one there. But if you, in any world, think that you're going to put beer in cans or bottles and you're going to send this out and it's going to go out to the store shelves and all that, you got to, for God's sakes, be able to measure package oxygen. If you are not, you're sending out oxidized beer, and it's, you think it's fine, and you're checking, like, you know, you can't package it and then, like, send it to somebody else to check, because by the time it gets there, the oxygen has already oxidized a lot of the beer, and you're sending out something very questionable. So I would just urge everyone who wants to package beer, make cans or bottles, with mobile bottling or canning and all this stuff, for God's sake, spend the money on being able to test package oxygen. It will represent your brewery and craft beer so much better than just kind of letting it, winging it. And you're just like, oh, no, it's fine. I hear from everybody. Oh, it's okay. No, we sent it to a friend. And like a week later, he told us that the oxygen was really low. It's like, well, yeah, it was a week later.
So, Jay-Z, because you, as you say, people like when you go off on a little bit of tangent. That's why you learn stuff here. Do you think that there's a difference between TPO, total package oxygen, and DO? Because very often we just talk about dissolved oxygen, right? But I was speaking with Vinny up there at Russian River, of course.
Yeah, TPO is what you're trying to measure. Yeah.
That's he's the first one I've heard really say the difference, and I just thought it might be worth pointing out to brewers.
Right.
And he was explaining to me, for example, TPO has to be measured, you know, right then.
Yeah, yeah.
Even driving across town to your buddy with a TPO meter is not going to give you the most accurate reading.
Right.
Okay.
You have to do it immediately. Otherwise, the point is, the oxygen is very reactive. and it is oxidizing the compounds in the beer immediately. Mm-hmm. Oxidation happens pretty much right away. And within, you know, a few hours, it's all done. It's oxidized the crap out of your beer.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So you absolutely have to do that right away.
Okay.
Yes. All right. So that was my number
three.
Yeah.
Three.
So now we're on Palmer's number two. We're getting to the top here.
Good mash tun.
Ah, mash tun.
Not a good mash tun. Not a crappy mash tun. A good one.
Yeah. Well, there, you know, there's lots of options. I mean, these days we've got your brew in a bag setups that are very easy. Mm-hmm. You know, it can be a cooler, it can be a kettle. It can be a kettle with a false bottom or a cooler with a false bottom.
Right.
But I think having that effective wort separation system built into your mash tun and some degree of insulation built into your mash tun, especially at the homebrew level, makes a big difference in quality wort.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You know, to this day, one of the best mash tuns I had ever had in terms of keeping heat and separation was that orange igloo cooler with a false bottom.
Yep.
You know, I couldn't, like, change the temperature and I couldn't do steps with it, but it would stay right where I put it for the entire hour. It didn't budge at all.
Right.
And I like that you're pointing out wort separation and insulation.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. That's the name of the game. And yeah, interestingly, we did that show 2 weeks ago on all-in-one systems,
mm-hmm.
you know, where if you combine the kettle and the mash tun, like in the Grandfather or the Anvil Forge, that is an extremely convenient way to mash and boil. Really cuts down on the amount of cleanup and that you have to do. So, I don't know, I thought it was interesting when I was putting my list together that kettle and mash tun came out there at 3 and 2 for mm-hmm. myself.
Well, there you go. For me, number two, and I'm going to squeeze in my number 11, my 11th one here. And actually, I really went back and forth on this, was the ability to do cell counts, which is going to be, you know, either there's automated equipment now, which will do it for you consistently and fast, and that's really nice. Or you can get a microscope and a hemocytometer. But if you're not good at doing it, the results can vary. But it's very important towards pitching the right amount of yeast and getting great fermentation and checking viability and all that stuff. And then I would throw in there, should you forgive me for throwing more in, you know, like HLP tubes or plates, a way to check for contamination in your pitch. So every time before we pitch a new beer from a previous beer, we take a sample of the yeast. We're checking viability. We're doing cell counts. We're checking for contamination in HLP. We're doing you know, plates to look for morphology changes. We're checking the yeast. And I guess, you know, this is checking the yeast. That would be my number two is making sure that, you know, the yeast you're going to pitch is the right amount, the right quality, and that's really what's going to give you, you know, great beer. So that would be my number two. I can't live without that.
Now, Jamil, just to...
Not every time, but we do buy new pitches from, you know, various yeast suppliers like White Labs. Generally, we will run about 15 generations or so, 10 to 20 generations. It depends on when we start seeing any sort of change in the morphology on the plates, or we see any sort of issues with, you know, the way fermentation, pH, these things during fermentation. You want to be able to look at the yeast and see how an individual cell is growing. If it starts looking different, that's an issue. You want to check for contamination. And so just as a prophylactic measure, we buy new pitches of yeast every so often, so that we start up a new culture, and we you know, do it in parallel with, at the same time we're running, we tend to run like two pitches of 001 at the same time, so that at any time, and we try and stagger them so that at any time if there's a problem with one, we can switch over to the other and use the other for, you know, multiple beers, and then we order up a new pitch of the other to keep two ancestries running parallel. And so, you know, it gives us, you know, some protection that way.
Yeah. Good planning. Yeah.
I like to think so. And we've learned from experience where we've been screwed royally and dumped tens of thousands of dollars.
Oh, no. All right. We're getting down to number ones here.
Number one. John.
I wouldn't be surprised if it's the same one.
Could be.
But for me, the fridge and temperature controller, that is a maintainable, controllable fermentation environment.
I will say, when I was homebrewing, when I finally got actual control of the beer temperature for fermentation, it was night and day difference. It radically changed my world and the quality of my beer. I think it's one of the most precious things you can do. I mean,
would you say you didn't even start winning awards until you had temperature control?
No, I won awards before that.
Okay.
You know, it was more hit or miss until then. And then I was just like, oh, damn, I know what I'm doing now.
I see.
And I could, you know, ferment, you know, it didn't even matter if the recipe was good. I could, you know, make a winner.
Got it.
Yep. Yep. Yeah. Same here. I mean, being able to control that, just makes all the difference in the world. Yeah.
Okay.
All right, Jay-Z.
My number one. Now, I've got to preface this with, I'm assuming in your professional brewery, you've got fermentation temperature control. If you don't, then I don't know what the hell you're doing there.
You're not a professional brewer.
If you're not out of business yet, you will be. You should be soon.
You will be soon. Or should be soon. Well, I guess you could do it without it.
Well, okay.
There's certain times a year you wouldn't be able to brew, but yeah. Sure.
I mean, depend. Okay, rare barrel, for example.
Yeah.
Right? Now, I guess their fermentation, their initial fermentation is probably temperature controlled. Yeah. And then afterward, they sort of picked a warehouse that's moderately.
No, that doesn't qualify.
Okay.
Good try, though.
Yeah.
But I imagine there's some people in Belgium somewhere where when they pitch yeast, they don't even really pitch yeast. It's like, well, fermentation is up to God and, you know.
right.
And the weather and whatever. My number one is zinc. Mono or heptahydrate?
Really?
Zinc. I can't be in business without zinc.
I'm going to figure out. I'm writing their list down. Mono or heptahydrate?
Yeah, heptahydrate.
Okay.
I prefer the mono because there's less water in it, and I'm not paying for water.
What does this stuff do?
Well, zinc is critical to fermentation. Fermentation is critical to brewing. The vast majority of wort is zinc deficient, and especially when you want to repitch yeast, especially when you have consistent fermentation, especially when if you want to ferment big beers, you have to have zinc. The amount of zinc that's coming from the malt is dependent on the growing conditions, the soil, how much zinc it could take up from the soil. A lot of the minerals that yeast need are present in the malt, but it tends to be zinc deficient. There's just barely enough. It's interesting. I was talking to somebody about this. I don't know, yeast person or something. But
Liz,
or maybe like Charlie or somebody. It seems that yeast have developed. The yeast that we're using today have developed over time to match up kind of with the ingredients that we have, the malt, and, you know, just generally it all just kind of works together, and everything has kind of become self-limiting to, well, all right, if you want to make a beer of 4 to 5% alcohol, well, all the ingredients are there, and the malt wants to become, you know, the malted barley. The barley will become malted because of, you know, its natural proclivity to grow the sprouts and to do all this stuff. And the malted barley will become sugary because, well, it's just the enzymes are there to do it, and you just kind of hit the certain temperature. You can just kind of half-ass all this stuff. And, you know, there's the nutrients there for just about any yeast to produce a 4 to 5% beer. It will just all happen. It's pretty impossible not to make beer. You know, the natural things have natural selection has kind of driven us towards it'll make beer. But when you want to make really good tasting beer, when you want to make high alcohol beers, when you want to do all this, you're pushing it past that, well, here's where natural selection has gotten us. You have to really, it's like, you know, having everybody run a race. It's like, well, natural selection, yeah, people are alive, but some of us ain't going to run as fast as others.
Yeah.
And but then you've got, you know, people that, you know, Usain Bolt or whatever, you know, that's something special.
Yeah.
And maybe that's steroids. I don't know. But it is whatever it is. And, it, you know, it's because, you know, you've provided a certain environment, certain parameters that make that possible. But it's not going to happen every day. And a big part of it is wort's just deficient in zinc.
So would you say zinc is almost the steroids of the brewing?
Yes. I am on steroids.
Yeah,
literally, and my brewery is figuratively.
Okay,
if you go by that, yeah, I would go with zinc.
Well, I would say zinc is to iron what iron. Zinc is to yeast what iron is to blood.
Okay,
there you go.
All right, and well, you said just to clarify that you prefer the
monohydrate.
The mono.
Well, because it's now, less,
is it
less
a zinc
water.
Sulfate monohydrate or just zip? Pure zinc with water attached.
Zinc sulfate monohydrate. Yeah.
Okay.
I think there's sulfate in all of them, right? Yeah, and there's heptahydrate. So if you buy the zinc, I think Murphy's or whatever it is, the English based one, it's heptahydrate. So you need to use like 7 times as much or whatever, or not 7 times as much. There's 7 water molecules versus 1 water molecule.
Mm-hmm.
And the problem with that is, you know, a lot of the weight is water weight then. There you go.
Yeah. Okay.
So, you're just paying for a bunch of water. But you can get food grade either way, and you need a tiny amount. So in a 30 U.S. barrel batch or 30-some-odd U.S. barrel batch, we use like 4 grams.
Oh, wow.
You can use too much, and you can poison your yeast. You can use too little, and essentially, if you ever have fermentation, and I tell commercial brewing friends of mine, I'm like, they're like, yeah, this fermentation was taking forever on this big beer, especially collaboration. I'm like, we're going to do a collab. You need to use some zinc,
mm-hmm.
because when you have slow, big fermentations, it's because there's not enough zinc. I guarantee it. It'll ferment out at a nice steady pace and complete, attenuation if you have all the right nutrients there. If you have healthy yeast and you have every compound that they need to do their jobs, they will do their jobs. If you don't, that's when they struggle. That's when they slow down. That's when things fail. That's when the quality of the beer fails. And it's down to the one nutrient you need that is deficient almost all the time, other than, you know, you already give them air or oxygen, zinc. Zinc, 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 zinc.
Okay.
I can't run my brewery without zinc.
There we go.
Excellent.
Yeah. Well, I think that was a good show, a nice list.
Yeah, I think so.
And you know what, folks? Here's what I'm going to do for you. A lot of you get your podcast over on iTunes or Google Play and all that, and you never see the website. But with this particular show, I've marked down this entire list and separated them, both John Palmer's and Jamil's here. And I will put links to the things that they discussed, and you can come see the whole list. And if you want to pick some up yourself or just see exactly what they're talking about, it'll be on the Brewing Network website on this show page.
There you go. Actually, cool. See, you actually did something useful.
Yeah.
Don't talk about yourself being useless.
Again.
All right.
Yeah. I thought that was fun. Never mind.
All right. Great show. I think I'll come back and do this again.
All right.
Yeah.
6 months or 2 weeks. Hey, who knows? We'll just have to see what happens.
Well, keep taking care of yourself. We like to see you back here.
Well, I like to take care of myself.
Yeah.
You know that. Yeah. There's a time when, you need a little me time.
That's right.
You break out the candles.
At least once a day.
A little potpourri. Some lube.
Some Legos.
Tissues. Put some Legos.
Some zinc.
Yeah, Bezos. That's all it got her to take off her head. Oh, she put it back. See. Yeah. The good old Brewing Network.
Yeah.
Where would I be without you guys?
I don't know. Somewhere healthier, probably.
Yeah, somewhere healthier. Rich.
yeah.
Famous. Whatever it would be. I'd be there. I'd be somewhere other than here, that's for sure.
Yeah.
All right. Till then, everybody, brew strong.
Brew strong, everyone.
I want people to believe me when they taste my beer. That's what it's about.
You mean you laid underneath it and tried to
put his tongue up the bung?
I like to actually scoop up the yeast and look at it.
7 o'clock came real early that next morning.
Oh, yeah, man.
Thanks for dumbing that down for us. You did an awesome job.
It's all about food and beer.
Punch me in the junk.
Man, that thing was thick.
The point is, just beat it like it's your dick.
I like to smell it afterwards.
Are you being sarcastic?
No.
Right now?
Yeah. Bring your body armor.
I ran into my jungle once on a ball valve on a kettle.
That's a true happy ending.
Now, live from the Brewing Network studios in Northern California, this is the radio program for home brewers, craft brewers, beer lovers, and beer geeks. It's your only source for live beer radio that brings expert brewers together with, well, expert drinkers. This is the radio program with a head on it. This is The Session.
Good day, boys and girls. I'm your host, Justin Crosley. This is The Session, and we're joined today by Beardy, who made it back from the Yukon.
I did.
Alive.
Candy couldn't kill me.
She couldn't do it.
Nope.
We'll find out if she tried or not.
Oh, she tried very hard.
Teresa Pasuti is back in the studio with us today.
Hello. Always happy to be here.
It's good to see you. And everybody's made it down through the heat wave we're having here. Bevo's in the studio. And even the lovely Abigail is in the studio today, but she's got earmuffs on.
Smart.
Rightly so. Yeah. Today, we got a great program for you. Eight Bridges Brewing Company from Livermore, California is going to be on the show with us today. And I want to thank our sponsor, Morebeer, for bringing you this session and everything that we do. You can go to morebeer.com and check it out. And go take a look at their Viking Malt. It's the best stuff on the planet. And you can get it over at morebeer.com. And thank them for being a sponsor for this long. We can't do this without them, believe me. All right, so Beardy, let's get right into it. You made
yes.
it back alive.
I did.
And I think I saw a photo of you in front of the Into the Wild bus.
You told me I had to go there.
We discussed this, that some people die all the time.
We said don't go there.
Oh, I missed the don't part.
Was it photoshopped or did you make it to the bus?
I made it to a bus.
Oh.
It looked identical. It looked like the bus.
So that was the bus in the movie.
Buses are in the woods.
Okay.
The movie bus is not across a dangerous river, which we did cross one of those, just not that one.
I see.
This bus was located in a parking lot of a brewery. That's about 10 miles or so from the park.
Oh, that's
my
cool.
God. I was actually like about to contact the authorities.
Yeah.
Yeah, you had me snowed.
Yeah. So I did Photoshop out. They have it decorated with like some Christmas lights and some weird things,
okay.
I guess, to probably make it more obvious that it's not the real one.
And maybe it's so that it like looks less like death, like a death trap.
Yeah, maybe a little bit more homey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. So I Photoshopped that part out.
Okay.
But I was sitting in front of a bus.
Got it.
Yeah.
That is awesome. That's too super funny.
We didn't have time to get there because it's a whole day trip basically to get to the real bus.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And you have to cross that river that made
river.
Him stuck. That's why he died. He was stuck there because of the river.
I read that he got stuck because, well, I guess he ate some seeds that made his legs not work.
Oh.
And so then he ended up not being able to get food, and he just starved.
I feel like that was a combination. I thought that he first was like, okay, well, shit, now I have to wait another season here because of the river. But then at that point, didn't know how to survive another season, ate the wrong berries, and slowly disintegrated.
It's hard to say. I don't think his journal was very detailed, other than he's just like, I'm broken. Please come help.
Right.
And no one was there to read it.
The smartest person on earth.
No.
Great movie, but I think people idolize the kid a little too much.
Yeah.
He's kind of a dumbass.
I think they romanticized some ignorant.
Yeah.
Youthful teenager.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, and it's like you want to be able to invent the whole world and figure it all out from scratch.
Yeah.
And,
right.
I mean, just think if breweries did that. Like, what kind of bad beer you would make.
Yeah.
It'd
be really sad.
It happens, by the way.
I have
seen it once or
twice. Yeah. They said he went in without a map, and he did document where he crossed. And if he had a map, he could have seen that less than 3/4 of a mile away from where he crossed, there was essentially a bridge.
Amazing. I'm glad he explored his surroundings.
Exactly.
Even. Like, forget a map. He was there long enough to take a walk 3/4 of a mile.
He went to the one place he crossed, and he was like, well, if not here, then nowhere.
I guess it's over.
Oh.
Yeah, right. Might as well go back to the bus.
Wow.
Yeah. So
can we also address the berry situation? Because you guys were eating some berries.
Oh, yeah. Candy found some really tasty berries. Have you ever had cloud berries before?
No.
Oh, man.
These are wild?
Yes.
Did you guys have, like, a book for this to figure out what to eat and what not to eat? Because that's the other way this idiot died.
So Candy thought she knew what they were.
Uh-oh.
Her guess wasn't cloud berries.
Okay.
So I had one, and it tasted so good, I basically ate the whole bush.
Wow.
But
how were you certain it wasn't poisonous? For real?
We were, well... My certainty was based on her certainty that it was something that it wasn't.
Oh, my God.
You're still, supposing she wasn't trying to kill you? Because
right, I told you. She tried very hard. She was encouraging me. And went,
right.
Yeah, so I basically ate the whole bush.
Did she eat any of them? Because that should have been a tell also.
Right.
She had blueberries in her hand at the time.
Wow.
I don't know. Maybe she was just putting it in her mouth and turning and spitting it out.
Yeah.
But, yeah. They were great, though.
I met some listeners in Colorado that I've met them before. They came out to our anniversary party there, the Hop Grenade, and they came up to me, and I was kind of—it was kind of in passing, so I was confused. But they were worried about you. They were worried about you dying, right?
Yeah, they should be.
Well, and all I remembered is that after the show, you and I talked about it too, and I was worried about you dying by wild animal.
Yes.
And so they come up to me and they're like, we're worried about Beardy. Like, is he alive? You know? And I'm like, and I started to say like, oh yeah, by the way, I'm serious. Like, I'm serious about him dying. I wanted to give him my gun. I wanted him to take my gun. It wasn't until I walked away that I realized, wait, they were talking about your wife killing you. They were talking about Candy. Because as I was walking away, I sort of heard them say like Candy. And I was like, I must have just sounded like an insane person. that I wanted to give you my gun so that your wife didn't kill you.
You wouldn't have been okay if that's how I used it?
I mean, I would have been fine with it. But I was like, I was just thinking more practically that we were talking about you taking my pistol in case a bear or something.
Oh, right.
You know?
That's what I was assuming you meant.
And that's what I assumed that they meant too. But they were talking about Candy killing you, and I must have sounded like an axe murderer. When I said how serious I was.
Oh, yeah, and you wouldn't be on my side in that scenario.
No. So, yeah, I would have given her the gun if was the case. Yeah.
But,
well, so overall, like, no issues? And where did you go again?
We went to Denali. We spent 3 days in Denali. We hiked. We rode the bus into the park about over 30 miles, and then we walked about 6 miles from the road.
Okay.
And it was our first hour spent with carrying a backpack at all in our lives.
Ever, okay.
And it started raining on us. Turns out my waterproof shoes that I even extra waterproofed before going on with some spray weren't waterproof.
Okay.
So I was basically walking in sponges.
Ouch.
And it was great. So we ended up, because Candy was so terrified of crossing the river.
Okay,
She wanted us to walk up through the bush. And this was like steep hills covered in plants. And it turns out in Alaska that there's a ton of moss on the ground.
Oh.
But it also turns out that that's not the ground. It's just a moss layer full of holes underneath and pools of water.
Oh, no.
So you'd be walking along and all of a sudden you just...
Wow.
And you'd be like down to your knee or deeper.
Wow. So it's like falling in a snowdrift, but
trap
it's
doors.
A moss drift.
Exactly. Yeah. And so she had me doing that. Literally on the edge of 80-foot cliffs down to the river.
Oh, my God.
Okay.
And you still think she's not trying to off you?
Oh, no, I was certain of it. But...
because she was there also. Oh, yeah. Like, she was...
I mean, how much research did you guys do on the terrain and what you might run into?
I knew that we were going to be following a river.
Got it.
And that we would have to cross it at some point. So I had water shoes. I was ready.
Yeah.
But... like I said, it rained, and the river only got stronger. And so that's why we didn't actually get to do our original plan and walk around. We were going to hike around a mountain called Cathedral Mountain, but the river overnight rose nearly a foot.
Wow.
Wow.
Did you all see any other living people out there once you got off the bus?
In Denali?
Yeah.
No. We didn't see anybody for 3 days.
Yikes.
Oh. It was beautiful.
Okay.
And worth the trip.
Yeah.
But... yeah.
What about like mosquitoes and bugs and stuff? I heard that those can be real bad out there.
I was really paranoid about that.
Yeah.
And so I got all of the layers of bug protection.
I see.
And sprayed our clothes and had bug lotion. Like, it's a pepper extract, not the DEET shit that'll kill your nerves.
Okay.
And we had no problems.
Oh.
I didn't get one bite.
Did you see, like, they were there though? They just avoided you?
Oh, yeah. They were
hovering
around and they wouldn't land. So
wow.
If you get it, the bug spray that I got is like pemerethrin or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
That stuff works.
Okay.
You just got to spray it on beforehand.
Okay.
But yeah, no bugs. Saw some moose. Nice. I actually got to walk. We went to an animal preserve because we didn't get to see a bear or anything in the wild.
I love that you had to, after all that, you had to go to an animal preserve.
No, but it's better to not see the bear in the wild.
I was okay with not seeing it in the wild. We saw tons of bear poop.
Okay.
And actually, we'd walked for over 8 hours the first day, and it was 11 at night, and the sun was going down finally at 11
out
there.
Wow.
Okay.
And Candy was like, I'm not walking any further. You need to find a place to put up a tent because that's going to be it.
Yeah.
So it's getting dark. I put up the tent. I walk 100 yards like you're supposed to put your food in a different spot, go back, and then we go to sleep, wake up in the morning. And we hadn't seen any sign of bear at all the first day.
Mm-hmm.
When we're on our way to go have breakfast, we find a fresh, giant pile of bear poop right in between our tent and the food.
Wow.
Yeah.
So he was
so
there.
They made themselves known. But
did you have – where do you put the food? Like, how do you keep it from getting eaten? Do you have to bring, like, a bear box with you?
Yeah,
you
it's a plastic box. And actually, the park rangers at Denali will give them to you for free to
I
use
see.
In the park.
Because they don't want you to die.
Oh, exactly. Cool. They prefer – well, they don't want to shoot the bear if they get the taste of human.
Got it.
So
they
care more about the bear.
Do you suspend them in a tree?
We didn't because there weren't really any trees close by.
Oh, okay.
But you just put it in a big open place. Kind of like
I would have suspended myself in a tree.
It would have been safer, probably.
Yeah.
instead of laying covered in bacon like I did.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we just left it out, and you're supposed to put it 100 yards away from where you sleep, and then also 100 yards away from where you eat and cook all your meals and whatever. And okay. So that way the bear's not going to put two and two together of, oh, hey, there's a tent. There's going to be food down there.
Yeah.
And so if it does happen to find your food, you're okay.
It's elsewhere.
Yeah.
It's terrifying. Yeah. Well, I'm glad you made it back.
Yeah. You want to come with me again?
No.
We're going to do it again.
I don't think it's about you guys liked it, huh? You're now backpackers?
We'll see.
Yeah.
We have a lot of backpacking gear now.
Right.
I know a guy, I could get it to you real cheap.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if backpacking is my thing.
Yeah.
I don't think I can carry enough beer on my back.
Yeah, that's the problem. You need to have like trail angels that will be there with your beer.
Yeah.
At the end.
I've recently learned, I've always wanted to take like multi-day rafting trips. I really like rafting. But I always thought, I'm not going to go that long without drinking. But I found out there's ones that they'll lug all your stuff, tons of beer, wine, everything. Like every night you camp, they're just make you dinner, you have all the booze, you're good to go. So I was like, oh, well, I can raft then.
You know, my friend runs a rafting company, and she was going to set up a trip. Hopefully she'll really do it this summer. It got canceled last summer.
Oh, yeah.
Or maybe next summer.
Right.
Given that it's we're almost
there already.
But we were going to do like a beer pair dinner rafting thing, like a multi-day trip.
I'm in.
Yes.
I love this.
This would be super cool.
I'm a rafting fan.
I met some people that actually do combo. They backpacked upriver. And they had like a small inflatable raft and then rafted back.
Okay.
And I thought that sounded like a really cool
trip. Super fun.
That's too much for me. I just want to get in the thing and let gravity, you know, take me down the river.
With your cooler of beer.
If it's somebody else dragging my cooler of beer, yeah. all right. Well, you're alive, and that's a good thing.
We made it.
Okay. We can talk more at the end of the show if we have time. I'm very fascinated by this trip.
Yes.
Let me get through some announcements today before we get to our guest, which, like I told you, is Eight Bridges Brewing Company. Announcements are brought to you today by Drake's Brewing Company. You can go to Drink Drake's, and they're about to celebrate 30 years of beer. That'll be this Saturday, I think, the 24th. Is that next Saturday?
Next Saturday.
Next Saturday. So get your tickets. You can go to drinkdrakes.com, and you're going to want to check it out. They're a great brewing company, and we appreciate their support and been around for 30 years in craft beer. That's a big deal right there. If you want to support this show, you can do your Amazon shopping by clicking on the Amazon link. That's on our homepage. And if you don't see it, it's because you have your ad blocker blocking things. You can also support us by joining the BN Army. Just click the donate button, and for as little as $2 a month, you're entered into the More Beer monthly donation giveaway, which is a chance to win $100 to spend at More Beer. We draw a name each and every month, and the more you donate, the more chances you have to win. So thank you to all of those of you who do that. It's been a great way for you to support us for all these years, and we thank you. Also, we've got a lot of shows here in the Brewing Network. Don't forget Brew Strong, Hop and Brew School, Heads and Tails, The Sour Hour. We've got something for everybody here, so share it with your friends. All right, you can get updates over on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We do fun stuff over there. For example, if you were on our social medias, you would have found out that our Pale 31 collaboration, Grenadier,
yes,
that we did with Firestone Walker came out, just came out on Friday.
It's out?
It's out.
You seen it?
I saw pictures of it. I haven't had it yet.
Me neither.
I think we're supposed to get it here at the Hop Grenade next week.
All right.
But I know that it's been released, and you can find it in the mixed pack on the shelves. It might take another week to get to all of the markets, but I do know that it's going out nationwide.
Okay.
And you'll see the Brewing Network's Hop Grenade right there on the packaging.
Is that a 12-pack or a 24?
I don't remember. Both? I don't know. I think it's a 12.
You better at least get six at a time.
I ordered four cases for here, but it's a mixed case. So that's if it's a 12-pack, so three in every one will be ours. Plus, I ordered kegs for here.
Okay.
I don't know that anybody else is going to get kegs. It might just be Hop Grenade that gets kegs and everybody else gets the bottles. But we're going to try them both.
Yeah.
Hopefully we'll have them here by the next time we're on the air. I don't know. They said sometime next week. It's going to take a little while for us to get them.
Are we actually going to share the kegs? Or is it just
the kegs?
Our beer?
Oh, no. We'll put them on tap here. I got to put the kegs on tap. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, sorry.
Fine.
Just hang out here for a few days.
Okay, fine.
You know, yeah. All right. We have a Twitter game today, Beardy?
Of course we do.
That's great. Twitter game's brought to you today by the American Homebrewers Association. And American Homebrewers Association is a community of more than 45,000 homebrewers who share an abiding love for beer. Head over to homebrewersassociation.org for brewing resources, recipes, and a healthy dose of homebrew culture. And if you're not a member, you can click the AHA link on our homepage. It's on the left side there. And become a member, and we get a little piece of the action for that. So, there you go. What's our Twitter game?
All right. So, I don't know if you've noticed, but we've been doing a lot of traveling here. Bevo was just in New Orleans.
Oh, yeah?
I was in Alaska.
Yeah.
You were in the house bus in Wyoming.
That's right.
I think Teresa went camping recently.
We've been all over. Yeah.
So, I think the BN needs to open up a travel agency and monetize all of our experience.
Okay. I like this idea.
I want to crowdsource an idea of what our first vacation package would be.
Okay.
Like, what would be our curated trip?
Yeah.
I think we could put together a pretty good
I think
event.
This is a legit idea.
I think we even we had a vacation company reach out to us asking us to do just this.
I know. I'm crowdsourcing.
So, yeah. All right. So send what would the Brewing Network perfect first vacation be?
Exactly. What do you want to do with us and where do you want to go?
There we go. All right. I like it. Very good. Okay, let's do a little bit of feedback. Feedback's brought to you today by the Beer Law Center. You can go to beerlawcenter.com. Check it out. John takes care of my trademark. He can do the same for you. Also, he can help you with all your brewery filing and more. He's a one-stop shop, and he's just a great guy, and he works a little too hard for me. Go to beerlawcenter.com. A lot of feedback about the feedback about JP.
Whoa.
A couple weeks ago where he got bashed by one listener for the mean and terrible interview he did with who was the brewery?
It was from Utah.
It was Lynn.
Toasted Barrel.
Toasted Barrel. Lynn from Toasted Barrel.
Yeah, Lynn Litchfield was the guest.
Okay.
And this listener wrote in a couple of weeks ago now and saying how awful and mean JP was, that he couldn't believe it. He really kind of tore him a new one.
Yeah.
So Lynn wrote in.
Oh, wow. Angry Lynn.
Oh, did JP send that to you?
Good. The guest wrote in.
That's awesome.
And he says,
and
hey, JP, I don't know if it matters, but listening to Michael's feedback on this week's session makes me laugh. What the fuck is he talking about? Saying that you guys were shitting on me and my beers? I didn't get that at all. I almost wish you were in the other seat, actually, so you could have teased me and joked more. Mike sounds like an out-of-touch douche. I had a blast hanging out with y'all, and y'all made me feel very comfortable, even when I spilt my beer. Show this to Justin. that's probably why JP sent it. JP does a great job when he's at the helm. Fuck that other guy. Love you all and suck it. Cheers from Lynn. And then he says, maybe I should have emailed during the break that JP's a big jerk.
Yeah.
Because that's how you get messages to
directly.
JP. You got to email him at the break.
Yeah.
I make a mistake one time.
So, yeah.
He did almost have a catastrophic beer spill.
He did.
Yeah.
I forgot about that, actually.
I did also.
Did it? But it didn't make it to
but
the
it
board?
Was like,
no,
it was like
it was going.
Soundboard adjacent. Oh, yikes. Yeah.
I might still be the only one to have ever done it directly on the board more
really?
Than once.
No, Scott did it once.
Okay. I think I've done it three times myself.
So. And it still works.
No. It's been replaced three times.
Oh, okay.
So did
really?
So did Taylor.
Taylor got one.
And Blickman took it apart. He was in the studio, took it apart, and cleaned it up for him.
You're kidding.
Of course.
No, dead serious.
That would have been this board, too. The good, the expensive
board.
One.
It was that board.
And John took it apart, like
Blickman,
right here in the studio?
In the studio, took it apart, dried it out.
God, I love John Blickman.
He was like, and then he was the presses.
Yeah.
I can fix
that. That guy's
this.
Amazing.
Wow. Okay. All right. Here's a little bit more about that show, though. Rob writes in. Hi, guys. I felt like I wanted to write in after listening to the Humble C episode of the session where feedback from listener Mike kind of ripped into JP and how he allegedly treated Lynn during the Toasted Barrel episode. I just wanted to give you another perspective. At the risk of sounding like a kiss-ass, I think JP takes way too much crap from listeners. Sure, he can be an asshole. I do love that closing song, by the way. But I'm also kind of an asshole on occasion. So, in my opinion, as usual, JP did a great job hosting the episode and wasn't disrespectful in any way. I've mentioned it to Bevo when I've seen her at the BN booth at GABF. I love the dynamic that JP brings to the show. That said, my favorite episodes tend to be the ones that Justin hosts and JP co-hosts.
Oh.
But that's also because I love listening to Justin, especially when he has the occasional on-air meltdown. Long story short, JP does a great job and doesn't get enough props compared to the amount of shit he seems to catch. Cheers and thanks for everything you do for homebrewing and craft beer. Hope to run into you again. P.S. I'm also glad to hear Tasty's cancer is responding well to treatment. Sending positive thoughts and vibes, and hope he will eventually feel well enough to rejoin some of the shows. That's from Rob. Yeah, I hope to see him on some shows soon, too. I think he started treatment again this week after a week or two off, so I'll keep you up to date as I know. Crane writes in, let's see. Hi, BN. Insert bullshit praise about how awesome you guys and gals are. Then say some shit about how long I've been listening for. Now to the butt. You are growing a systemic problem with pompous, self-righteous listeners who have the audacity to write in and complain about a goddamn free show. Don't effing listen if it bothers you so much. From Crane. Okay.
Well, we just love to get hot and bothered, though.
True. And yeah. Crane, don't forget, we do encourage feedback of all kinds. And sometimes the negative stuff is the most fun.
And really what we encourage the most is paying for the shows, then writing and complaining about it.
Yes.
Yes.
You do have that
option. Complaints with a check, and they're always acceptable.
Yeah, that's right. Ben writes in, the douche nozzle who bashed JP from the previous show is way off. I listen to those shows back to back. Next time, break the pills in half, bro. Says, that is.
To the emailer.
Okay. Ian Titus writes in.
Ian Titus.
Yes, he's back.
Yes.
Here he goes. Ever been drunk and missed the last two beers in the cooler in your big mug? I had a local pills and a Red Hook ESB. Probably shit when sober, but badass when not. Sincerely, Ian Titus. Always my favorite emails from Ian.
Was he saying he had the two beers poured into the same mug?
That he did that himself, yes.
Right, so he made a custom blend.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That's amazing. A big-ass mug.
Yeah.
That's a beer cocktail right there.
Okay. Nate
Pilsner and
Red Hook ESB. Sounds like a diacetyl-y Pilsner.
Hmm. Yeah.
It could be fine.
You know, sweet diacetyl-y pills.
One of those fast lagers.
Right. I would try it. It'd be interesting. But it's, if you're actually asking a question, Ian, which I feel like that was a rhetorical question, no, I have never mixed the last two beers, but it's not a bad idea. It's never really crossed my mind either.
Yeah.
I
mean,
sometimes I've gotten down to the last two beers and I didn't want either one of them, so I just didn't have a beer. And now you've given me another option.
Both.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thanks for opening new doors.
Thank you, Ian Titus. All right. Nate writes in. Hello, BN. On your recommendation, I tried the Duke Cannon Shaving Cream. Fantastic. I lathered up with the stuff and did a proper shave, and wow, silky smooth and endlessly touchable. I found myself just running my fingers over it all day.
Gross.
It also seemed to work great on my face. Keep it up. From Nate.
Ew.
Well done.
Put the Duke on his cannon.
This one is more a series, although it's not formatted as such, is more a series of bullet points and kind of questions.
Very concise. Oh, questions.
Hello, Brewcasters. Thank you for the entertainment and information over the years. First point, tell us the truth. Doc can't be on the show anymore because of a clause in the divorce agreement.
Is he divorced yet?
I don't think he's divorced yet, so false.
You're right.
To the subject line, which JP didn't include, so I don't know what it is. Who has not been on the session that you would like to be on? So I guess what brewer guest? He says, specifically, I am looking for a response from each and every one of you individually. This one's easy for me. And in fact, I'm going to work on it. I just have I have another thing in the works before I do it. But Ken Grossman has never been on the session.
Oh, yeah.
I have done some tiny interviews with him, like a little bit at the GABF.
Yeah.
I think he was on an episode of Brew Strong or one of those years ago at a homebrew con.
Mm-hmm.
But he's never come in and done a full session. I've never invited him, actually, to come do a full session.
That might be the reason.
Yeah. But he's that one's easy for me. Ken Grossman. Yeah. And I'll make it happen one of these days.
He's the Moby Dick to your Ahab.
Yes, yes, yes. Beardy, do you have anybody?
I I think I'm pretty sure they haven't been on, but I'm not 100%.
Mm-hmm.
I would love to get, I think it's Austin Beer Garden.
Austin Beer Works, maybe? Or is it?
Beer Garden's in the name.
Okay.
But great brewery in Austin, killing it with all their beers. But never been on. Especially lagers.
I don't think they've ever been on.
Yeah. I think it's Austin City Beer Garden. Austin something. I really like them. You can tell because I don't know their name.
Yeah, great brewery. I'm just doing a quick search on our website, which, by the way, anybody can do. If you're looking for a guest and not sure they've been on, there's a little search button right there. I don't see them coming up here. So
yeah, they definitely haven't been on since I've been here.
Teresa, what do you think?
Well, I think it might be a long answer because I'm not as familiar with the backlog as you guys are.
Sure.
Have you had Three Weavers on?
Yes.
Next.
Back with their, but I don't know,
this
is Alex
like
still the
minutes.
Brewer there? Back when Alex was the brewer?
She's still involved in some capacity.
Then yes.
I'm going to have to pause that one.
Okay, that's fair.
I can do a little fact checking.
Austin Beer Garden Brewing, it's ABGB is their acronym.
Okay.
That's who we need to get on.
All right, write that down, Bevo. JP's not here. So he's out sick today. Bevo, can you think of any breweries?
No.
No, any Pete? We've had Sam Calagione on for you. We've had
on
Garrett,
the phone.
We've
like,
had
not
Garrett
in
Oliver
studio.
On for you. Not Garrett Oliver, Garrett Marrero, although Garrett Oliver's wonderful as well. We've had everybody with an accent that you like on, I think. So
maybe get Logan Plant in here in person.
Another in person, because he's been on, of
right,
course,
yes,
but
yeah.
Not in person. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You tell you what we should do is get Calagione and Jim Cook on together now that that would be a great interview.
That'd be the
two of them together.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if I'll find out if they're ever doing any events out here because in studio would just be killer.
Oh yeah, totally.
How fun would that be?
To arm wrestle.
Yeah. All right. Well, good question, Ben. And sorry, there's not more brewcasters here to help you out there. Oh, wait, he's not done yet. There's more bullet points here. I like the co-host's new format. I'm assuming he means having Teresa and Sully rotate in and out of here. So that's good. I'm still in favor of the Where Are They Now episode, he says, which would be like listeners. And I think someone wrote in, maybe Ben, a while back about, listeners that were around before a lot and brewcasters, Doc, for example. Mm-hmm.
We'd have to find him.
And then he finishes with really kind of tired. I want to make a bunch of old timer inside jokes, but I would probably mess up and go too far. So I'll stop here. Thank you, Ben. That was it.
Wow.
So he kind of fizzled out there.
That was a great concise email, Ben.
Yeah.
Thanks for the bullet
2:30
points.
2:30 a.m. I'm too tired.
The last one I want to get through. This one was sent to me personally, and it's worth reading. Even though it wasn't sent to the feedback email, but Matt wrote in a little bit of a long one, but you got to let me get through it because
Matt Brennelton?
No, as a listener, Matt, I don't know. All right, he says, I've been listening to Brewing Network shows for years, starting with Brew Strong and the Jamil Show. I've been a fan of the Sour Hour and Hoppin' Brew School from the beginning as well. Additionally, as a fan of craft beer, I know that companies like AB InBev are bad for the industry and especially bad for the small business owners trying to compete for their fair share in the industry. I've made it a point to no longer patronize breweries that sell out to AB InBev. I've always thought that the BN was more on the side of the good guys. I was able to look past the Northern Brewer ads during the time they were owned by AB InBev, as they had been longtime BN sponsors and were still being run by good people. Having said all this, I was beyond shocked when listening to Hop and Brew School this weekend and heard an advertisement for Michelob Ultra.
What?
This wasn't an ad for a former small business that was bought up by AB InBev in recent years.
No.
This was an ad for an AB InBev flagship brand that has no place on such a podcast and is extraordinarily tone-deaf to the targeted audience of the BN shows.
I know my wallet has a spot for that Michelob ad money.
That is awkward.
The NFL can market to light beer drinkers who want something they can chug down while watching the game, but the BN should not. You have lost one listener today, sir.
Oh.
And while
ouch.
I'm sure one listener is inconsequential compared to the advertising revenue you must be getting from AB InBev, I wanted to make sure that you understand that you can lose longtime listeners like me with this type of betrayal. I will choose to listen to podcasts that better cater to homebrewers and craft beer lovers. Good day, Matt.
Well, you know, we don't have any Michelob ads over on Heads and Tails on the Brewing Network.
Okay. So, Matt, first of all, and anybody else who heard an ad for Michelob Ultra, I have a couple of things to say about that. First,
it tastes great.
Is that I apologize that that happened. Second, I have not received a penny or a dime or a fucking love note, for God's sake, from AB InBev. And third, we have not sold out in such a way. This was an accident. As some of you will have noticed, you'll be noticing ads from different people than our normal sponsors as of late, especially in our back catalog of podcasts. And that is because we teamed up with a podcast delivery company who sells ads into the shows, and we get a portion of that. So it's like having a sales force out there working for you.
Sure.
And they just do all the work, and they put some ads in there. I refused to sign up for such a thing until I found out, until I was certain that I could exclude certain types of advertisements.
Oh, okay.
And that is how the program works, because podcasts are so highly targeted usually in their own niche. Obviously, ours is as well. They design the system so that you could opt out of certain categories. Mm. Now, so I opted out of alcohol. And I want to make some finer points on this. The first point is you couldn't subcategorize it all the way down to like macro beer. All I could do was exclude all alcohol. I did so for you and craft beer. Listeners, I'm talking to you.
Yeah, not me.
And I want to make a point about this. I did it because I thought it was the right thing to do, and any chance that a macro brewery could end up on our show bothered me, because it's not really who we are until I completely sell out, that is. So,
all or nothing, baby.
I opted out of the alcohol category for just this very reason, and I'm bringing this email up to point out that I would hope that you'd give me the benefit of the doubt. Because I think that up until this point, we here at the Brewing Network have done nothing but support craft beer and home brewing. Now, I understand you don't know this whole backstory, so I would be confused as well if all of a sudden I heard a Michelob Ultra ad. Now, I do want to thank Matt for writing in, because I wasn't aware of this, because I had opted out.
Right.
So I immediately, within 5 minutes of getting this email, contacted my podcast distributor and raised hell. And found out what the hell happened, and just something slipped through the cracks, and they couldn't even figure out what, but they immediately removed it and assured me that it would never happen again. So on one hand, I am very sorry. I don't know how many people were delivered those ads. Please do let me know if that happens again, because I need to tackle it immediately. Now, I just want to make one other point, and it kind of goes back to, like, I'm a little annoyed that you know, we're not given the benefit of the doubt, because, as I mentioned, I have to eliminate the entire alcohol category
right.
from advertising. And the way they decide who, what, and how much advertising to deliver on our podcast is by evaluating our demographics.
Sure.
And your subject matter.
Right.
Now, who do you think the number one moneymaker would be for the Brewing Network? What category do you think that would be?
Lingerie.
Close. Alcohol. So, in other words, if I didn't have to, I wouldn't want to leave out, say,
right.
whiskey manufacturer. Let's
Absolutely
say Jameson
not.
Wanted to buy into any alcohol company, frankly, other than those owned by, I agree with you, empires like AB InBev and those that edge out the competition, the very industry that has given me a living, I would love to be able to just exclude them. But in order for me to do that, and my principles are so firmly fucking placed in this philosophy that I'm leaving all of that other money out on the table.
Yeah.
By choosing to only support craft beer. And I just think that it's important that you all know that. Next time something like this comes up about whether the fuck or not we support craft beer, I think you ought to take a look at every fucking dollar I'm not accepting by choosing to be principled in this matter.
So did you send an email to Matt since he's not listening anymore?
I wrote back. And I wasn't quite as angry at when I wrote back.
Oh, okay.
But I did explain exactly what I explained now. And I even explained, like, hey, by the way, just what I said. I hope you know I'm not just I'm saying no to everybody's money in the category in order to stand for our principles about how important craft beer is to us as an industry.
Yeah.
So I felt it worth bringing this up, mostly because I'm afraid that a bunch of you heard that ad and didn't write in, and I wanted you to know that it's not okay, it's not acceptable, and that I went back and I made another point to make sure we're opted out, and then also just to point out that by doing that, don't be talking to me about my fucking principles in craft beer ever again, ever the fuck again, until I sell the entire company to AB InBev.
The Ashley Madison ads are intentional, and you should go there.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. Adult friend finder, all about it.
Right.
I didn't say I have principles in general. Yeah. I do not.
Oh, okay.
I do not in general have principles. But this industry has been very, very good to us. I'd like to think we've been good back, and we continue to do so. And I did not approve any such ads. So I am sorry to any of those of you who heard those, and I hope you'll now go forth and just let me know if you hear them so I can let these people know that they're fucking up again. But I'm told that it won't happen again. So we'll see what happens. Rant over.
Great.
It's just one of those things that happens when you hire a distributor. I mean, that's what all those little breweries think about. We're like, oh my God, what if, they shit the bed.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I did exclude other categories, too. I tried to curate as best I could things that I didn't feel, you know, fit within our segment. Like, I cut out kids. Like, kids and families was a category.
Right.
I thought that wouldn't be appropriate. They don't make these distinctions. They just want to sell ads, right?
Right.
Like
they
kind of blanket sell them. They look at demographics. They have an algorithm that figures out where they should go. And so I didn't want to fuck up that algorithm either. I took out, like, families. I took out kids. I think I even took out, like, education.
Right. Audible. Our listeners don't read.
Yeah.
Can you imagine, like, a Pampers advertisement?
Yeah.
It would be random.
So random.
I took out, like, fashion because I just thought it would be annoying to most of you.
Thank you.
So, but honestly, the alcohol one was really the only one that I was like, this can't happen. I know what they're going to do. They're going to inevitably going to end up with fucking Coors Light ads on here. I know, and I can't, even though that'd be some fucking cash.
Yeah,
that's not who we are, what we do. So I just had to do it. And
smart.
It is what it is now. So send us more fucking money, okay? That's what I have to say about
that. You got to make up for it, Matt.
Yeah. Yeah. Hit that donate button. You know. Okay. I'm going to get us to a break right now, and when we come back, 8 Bridges Brewing Company is in the studio with us. So hang in there. We'll be right back. You're listening to The Session.
Yeah. this is Julian Trago from Beechwood Brewing, and you are listening to The Session on the Brewing Network.
All right, welcome back to the program, and thank you for hanging out with us today. Also hanging out with us today, on the line at least, we've got Justin Beardsley from Eight Bridges Brewing Company out of Livermore, California. Welcome to the show, Justin.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going very well. Thanks for being here with us, man, or on with us, I should say. We've got your beer in our glass as well, so thank you for sending it over. Those of you who want to come down to the Hop Grenade, at least for the next few days, although we're quite busy, so it could be gone. We've also got some Eight Bridges beer on tap that you can have, and then Justin was kind enough to send us some extra beers, too. So I appreciate all of that.
Do you think he looks like a mashup of us, since his name is a mashup of us?
He looks like him cross between me and you, Beardy.
Yeah. Yeah, so deadly handsome.
That would be...
Let's see if I can find it on the website.
Be amazing, right? Justin, when did Eight Bridges open up? How long you guys been around?
We opened our doors in February of 2014.
Okay.
2014. Our first actual beer fest, actually, was the Winter Brews Fest.
Nice.
Off the opening.
I think I remember that even. Back when we were in the winter times.
The year before that, I was pouring with Jaden Roberto from Hop Tech, just as a home brewer.
Nice. Okay. And is that your... So were you a pro brewer before you opened, or just home brew?
No, I was a paramedic before we opened.
Oh, nice.
Oh, wow.
That might come in handy as a brewery owner,
yes,
now.
Yes, very handy.
You know?
Definitely some injuries that can occur.
Yeah.
You'll know how to handle it.
We try to avoid those. My workers' comp would prefer that.
Yeah, good call. Good call. At least sweep them under the rug. Yeah, that's what we do around here.
Dead bodies.
Yeah. Are you from Livermore? Is that why you guys opened up out there?
You know, I grew up in Pleasanton. Livermore was such a welcoming city they're welcoming to wine and craft brewing as well. So it was just kind of the easiest city for us to work with.
Yeah, that makes sense. There's several wineries. I used to work out at Wente out there. For several years. Actually, I built the Brewing Network's first website while working behind the bar at Wente. When it was slow, I would turn around and build a website on my laptop because my manager was super cool, and he was a beer fan, so he didn't care that I was building this beer geek website while I was on the clock.
Nice.
Yeah. All of our spent grain goes to Wente, too, for their cattle program.
Oh, that's awesome.
Really?
That's very cool. Yeah, and so for years, it was just a wine town, right? And how many breweries are out there now, do you know?
Open, we have three of us right now that are actually, or four of us, sorry.
Four now,
four
okay.
Four of us that are open, with another two, I think, that are really close to being open.
Wow, that's cool. Yeah, you guys get a little beer scene out there. I know Altamont and you guys. Who are the other two that are open?
Working Man and Shadow Puppet.
Oh, obviously. Right. I know all of these people. I'm just drawing a blank over here. Okay, very cool. Yeah, that's a good little beer scene out there. Now, you were a home brewer before, and I always like it when we get, you know, I was just a home brewer before, because I just always want to know, like, how you had the confidence to, fuck it, we're going to go pro. I'm going to, you know, I don't know. What size system did you open up with?
It's scary. So we opened up with a 10-barrel brew house.
Okay.
And I was brewing on a 10-gallon, so, you know, I only went up 31 times.
Right, yeah.
You know, but I spent the better part of a couple of years shadowing brewers from other breweries, joining trade organizations, things like that. I've been in the National Brewers Association for going on 6 years now.
Okay.
Really just trying to absorb and talk to and learn from as many people as I could as to what was I going to trip over when I was making that transition.
Right. Yeah.
You know, it helps. My background is in biology and mechanical engineering, so like brewing in a nutshell.
Yep.
So I really just kind of had to learn the specifics, like, you know, what specifically was I going to deal with?
Sure.
In that. So in that sense, it wasn't too bad, but it's still kind of scary, you know.
Yeah.
$50 of ingredients to a couple thousand.
Right.
Don't want to mess that up too many times.
Did you have to dump out any of your first batches?
Believe it or not, it took us almost a year before we had to dump a batch.
Oh, really?
Okay. Oh, congratulations.
Yeah.
You made it that far.
Yeah.
And it's only happened three times.
Okay.
Since we've been open. Once was due to a Belgian contamination in our yeast. Mm. And was the temperature controller froze closed, so our fermentation got up to like 90-something degrees before we caught it.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Yikes.
That one wasn't salvageable.
And it wasn't a kvike.
Right.
Right.
It was a fun experiment to see what 001 tastes like fermenting that hot.
But. Right. A fun one, but not fun on the checkbook. Not one you right. wanted to have to pay for.
No. And then we had another one where we actually had a phenolic off flavor come out in one of the beers. So we just said, nope, not even worth it. Just dump it, start over.
Okay. Okay, well, I like that you do that because, you know, there are brewers out there who, you know, believe it or not, there's some that won't dump a batch. They'll just figure out how to serve it. You know?
We made a Belgian pale ale this time.
Yeah.
No,
we called our dirty brown.
Russian River, and they got the call that a batch wasn't right. And he said, okay, dump it. And I asked him what it was. And it was a lot of Pliny the Elder, I think.
Okay.
Ah.
Yeah.
So you got to be able to make that decision. And it hurts, but it's better in the long run.
You know, and look, this happens in any business, and I think that maybe sometimes, you know, brewers, I know the purse strings can be tight, but every business has to throw some shit away every now and then, you know, go through some prototypes, I don't know what, so I think it's important that brewers not only do it, but, you know, don't beat yourself up too much, right? It just kind of happens sometimes.
Well, I think you have to, like, take a deep breath and be like, I am proud, I am you know, we're too good for this beer.
Yeah.
We're going to let it go.
Yeah. Remember that like you're playing the long game too, mm-hmm. right? So you want people to remember your good beers. And I'll tell you, I can remember some bad beers. You don't want me to do that, right?
Nope. Yeah, that's, you know, if I put them out and I call it, you know, Twisted Red, one of my best-selling not IPA beers, and I put something out and it doesn't taste the same, people are going to notice.
Yeah,
I've heard about this thing called making a bad beer. I've just not been able to do it yet.
Oh, God.
I know. You're just a little too perfect.
Yeah, Beardy.
It's a suffer that I have to deal with on my own.
Now, just back to you were able to gain enough experience. Obviously, it's still scary because now it's your bank account. It's your new system. But obviously, one I think... I don't know if luxury is the right word. A nice thing that up-and-coming pro brewers or aspiring pro brewers have is they can do what you did, and that's just go spend time in breweries. It's a cool industry that people will let you do that. So you had – it's not like you had zero experience.
And it's getting a little harder. I think a lot of people are afraid of, you know, what if that person comes and gets hurt or whatever, and then there's that whole lawsuit
sure.
that scares them. So I was lucky that I was able to find some people. Drake's was one of them. I showed up on a random Saturday that they were actually even brewing and was able to hang out. I was there for probably 8 hours just
nice.
Talk to a couple of different brewers that were there. So it was nice to be able to do that and find some people you could do that with.
And, of course, if you care enough about your home brewing, and I assume that at some point you knew you wanted to go pro, so you probably even looked at your home brewing from a different perspective once you decided that, you can practice a lot of the things that you're going to see in the brew house, you know, yeast management and temp control and recipe development, right?
Absolutely. Well, that was one of the things. So my parents are investors
okay.
in me. In order to prove to them that I could actually do this, I actually had to brew. I had 5 different recipes that I had to brew on a consistent basis and brewed them the same every time. And in order to get rid of the beer, we just threw a bunch of, like, tasting parties on their deck.
Got it. Nice. But,
that kind of scared us. That was the Pilsner, which you guys have on tap at.
Yep.
They're the Pilsner, Golden Nectar, Twisted Red, Nottingham Brown, which we don't have out right now. A Kolsch, and then what would eventually become the Hoppy Salvation. And so of all of those recipes that were there, I actually still make all of those.
Nice.
And that was kind of fun doing that.
Was this your parents' rule? They are the ones who said, if you can do this consistently, you know, 5 times each, we're all in? Is that what it was?
That was exactly it. They wanted to make sure that I wasn't just going to show up and have something different come out of the tank every time, even though it was the same ingredient.
Got it. Yeah. Hey, I like them. I think that's a good test.
Yeah.
Especially on a homebrew scale, because Tasty talks about that a lot, right? Like being able to consistently brew it. Some brewers are like, I don't have to do that. I don't like this.
It's art.
But, and that's fine, too. But you know what? If you want to become a pro brewer, you do have to do that.
At least you have to have the ability, right? Like you can choose not to do it. I used to think those people were crazy, but then I've seen so many of them be so successful with that model. It's like, okay, you do you.
Yeah.
But I'm with you. Like, I want my Kolsch to taste the same every time. But if even it doesn't, it's like not good.
You're not happy, of course.
No.
Well, then, okay, even the practice of doing it, even if that's not going to be your brewery model, you're going to go, fuck it, we're just going to come out with a new beer every week.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
But the practice of doing, of repeating, mm-hmm. is still valuable.
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
Well, I am totally in agreement with Justin. It's like quality is producing the same good product over time.
Yeah.
Like, it's not just doing it once. It's not like a one-hit wonder, you know?
Yeah.
That's one of the smartest tests I've heard.
The quality, so.
Good.
That's one of the smartest tests I've heard a potential investor give to a new brewery owner or like brewery entrepreneur.
I know, never mind that they're family. That's just a standard good test.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I want you to brew the same beer twice, please.
Yeah,
and
at
then
least.
We'll see. Right, yeah.
You know.
That's great.
Are they happy they're investors now?
I think that they are. They're having fun. I'm lucky, I work with them too, you know, continuously. My dad, George, does a lot of the sales planning and everything and some of the business side. And my mom runs the book. So.
Oh, that's excellent.
Oh, that's so cool. So they're actually working with you.
Yeah.
True family biz. I like
that. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
We ended up meeting the Ashworth that way too, which was fun. She came over and that was what cemented it for him.
Told
him, quit doing this. Just open up.
Ah, very. In case you don't know, Judy, ladies and gentlemen, the godmother of craft beer, is what we generally call her around here. Supported craft beer before anyone knew
what
to. What do you say?
She's my beer grandma.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Man.
She's an angel, and craft beer needed her before they even knew it. So that's cool. That's a good. Well, that's a good endorsement you got there, Justin. Very nice. Now, before we taste your beer, we've got some in the glass, but I wanted to bring up something else that I found in my notes for you, and that's that you don't mess around with too many ingredients. You like water, hops, yeast, and malt.
We have some here and there, but I'm kind of a purist when it comes to beer.
And
thank you.
Not just any. I bring that up too because some of the ingredients you mentioned are semi-common in craft beer now, like dextrose and corn sugar, for example. But you like to derive your fermentables almost without exception from all malt.
That's good. Yeah, that's correct. Some people use dextrose because they want to lighten things up or dry them up. I prefer to do that with mash temperatures. Or just using, there's tons of really light malts out there that you won't get a ton of color from. So I figure, why put something in there that's nutrient deficient for the yeast? For me personally, I can taste a beer that's got dextrose in it. I feel like the alcohol flavor of it just isn't quite as well balanced as I would like. So, for me, I think it's for me and my taste buds and my preference and the product I like to put out. It's about doing it right. And that's not to say that we don't have some fun with ingredients. We definitely have used blood oranges. We do a Belgian Golden Strong with a blood orange caramel that I make in-house out of blood orange juice and sugar and things like that. So, we do have some fun with it within certain style elements.
Okay.
But we don't, I don't use it for, like, warp extension or, which is the technical term for getting more alcohol without using more malt.
Sure.
I would rather brew, like for us, brewing something over 9%, can't even brew a full-sized run of that because I can't fit that much malt in my mash tun. I would rather do it that way and do a 7.5-barrel batch twice than get a full 10 but use something else.
I see. You'll make exceptions with like a Belgian style, though, like if it requires candy sugar or something like that.
Got it, and we'll do that.
Okay.
But that's an important flavor element for those beers anyway.
What about a double IPA or something like that?
Never have used it in double IPAs or triples for that matter.
Wow, even a triple.
You'll just double batch if you have to.
And my triple IPAs will dry. Actually, I've been able to get my triple IPAs almost a full-size batch just because we're actually able to dry them out so much. We get down to about 10.08.
Okay.
Still getting down that low. Triple. Nice.
So we definitely have good quality control with our yeast and things like that in order to be able to just get it to do what we want it to do.
Yeah.
Excellent.
You got to be on top of it to do that.
And wait, you mentioned a house-made blood orange, like, what is it, like a...
It's almost a caramel, right? So there's no milk in it or butter or anything like that. It's basically just a syrup we make from blood orange juice and cane sugar.
Okay.
Really,
you just kind of make like a reduction out of that?
Candy sugar. Yeah.
I see.
So we use that instead of candy sugar in our Golden Strong, and then we hit it with a bunch of blood orange zest that I hand zest off of fresh blood oranges.
Wow.
Just to do, I mean, that's kind of the fun part with being small enough, you know. I only have to do a case or two of blood oranges instead of, you know, 100 pounds or 200 pounds or something like that.
Sure.
That's kind of the fun part. You know, if we were a whole lot bigger, it just wouldn't be fun or effective to do things like that. So
that also sounds delicious.
It does.
It's good. And I only do that during blood orange season, so I ensure.
Which is like January, February time, or?
Harvest is in late December.
Oh, late December. Okay.
And usually the beer will come out around our anniversary.
Hmm. Nice.
I'm going to have to keep an eye out for that one. All right. Let's talk about some of the beer in our glass. We've got the first one it looks like a sour saison you did. You're slightly strawberry.
It is. That was kind of a fun one. That was probably my tastiest mistake we've made.
Oh, boy.
Tell us about that.
We do kettle sours, and just because I like to keep the bugs out of my tanks, just in the boil kettle.
Okay.
The pH just didn't drop to where I wanted it to, so I said, the heck with it. I'll just let it keep going until it gets to where it wants to go.
Uh-huh.
When I did that, it ate up almost all of the fermentable sugars to the point where I ended up with like a 2% sour.
Wow.
Which tasted good, but wouldn't sell because nobody pays for 2% alcohol.
That's a good point.
So I said, well, okay, what do I do with this? I could throw it away, but it tastes really good. I could brew another sour that's a little bit higher in alcohol and blend them together. And I've been wanting to do a saison, and I feel it's really important for a good saison to have a slight sour element to them.
Mm-hmm.
So I turned around and used it as an excuse to play around with another style of beer. So brewed almost 11% alcohol saison with a French saison yeast.
Wow.
And then took the two, did some test blends real quick to figure out the ratios. Didn't quite use all the sour, but used enough of it. And put that together, and it tasted really good. And then I said, you know, this would be really good with strawberries, too. So I split the batch because I had, you know, twice as much as I was planning with. And half of it went into port wine barrels, and the other half of it just went out for sale. And that's the slightly strawberry, the strawberry aged in port barrels.
Got it. Did you get the port barrels from a place there in Livermore?
Yeah, actually, there's a Bent Creek Winery. They take care of me on barrels. They call me every couple of weeks or every couple of months whenever they drain one. And,
nice.
They get a little beer. I get some nicely used port barrels. It's a fun relationship.
That's a win-win. Now, just to back up for a sec, because you said the pH didn't get to where you wanted it to, so you just let it go and see where it was going to end up. Does that mean you just let it keep sitting in the kettle until it was done, or you had to...
Fermenting in there, and it was an anaerobic fermentation
to
get the lactic acid out of it.
And how long did it sit there until it decided it was done?
Believe it or not, it was only another 12 hours before it chomped through everything.
Oh, interesting.
It was ripping. It had almost as much Kroizen in it as I get out of my fermenters.
Wow.
With regular yeast.
Okay.
So how do you execute your kettle sour? How do you what do you like to use to bring to produce the lacto?
I use the Lallemand's sour pitch.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I use that one too.
I messed around with a couple of strains. I found that the Plantarum was just the most forgiving and you know, worked reasonably fast. Not as fast as some of them. You know, it's usually a solid 36 to 48 hours. And I've heard of other strains going a little bit quicker, but the flavors on that particular strain, I preferred.
Mm-hmm. This is a good beer. It's not just the strawberry. I think the port barrel was a really nice choice because the strawberry is subtle, as strawberry almost always is, right? It's kind of hard to get that.
Yeah, it doesn't have a whole lot of flavor. It's just really acidic.
Yeah.
Kind of after fermentation.
So then the port kind of brings in, like a white grape, you know, almost honey, but like a white grape honey type of sweetness.
Yeah.
Yeah. The French Saison gets a lot of pear flavor out of it.
So okay.
Everything kind of goes together really well.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like the restrained phenol character from the Saison yeast. Mm-hmm. It's definitely not overpowering that I think it could easily do in this beer with the delicate strawberry and port flavors.
The French version of it, too. If I did the Belgian version, it would have been probably peppercorns.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. We're up in the mid to high 80s fermentation on this. So.
Okay. Nice and warm.
So definitely. Weird walking by the fermenter and putting my hand on the manway and feeling it.
Yeah, it being warm.
Yeah, and not just automatically thinking something's broken.
Yeah, not going into panic mode.
You're like, shit, the glycol again? Yeah. And then just like a little bit of oak. Not much, just a little tiny.
Little tannin.
Tan, you know? Yeah, that's a nice mix right there. How long was it in the port barrels?
It was about 4 months.
Okay.
Not a huge amount of time, just enough to pick up just a little bit. And it's one of those things, too, where I'll taste it every so often just to kind of see where it's at.
Got it.
And when it hits a point I like, then that's where we pull it.
That's the way to do it.
What did the ABV end up being with the blend?
If I remember off the top of my head, it's 5.7.
Okay. Because an 11% Saison, that's a big Saison.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, making up for the two
right.
point.
Yeah.
It's too bad. It's not too bad because you ended up with a happy accident here. But, you know, table beer was a thing at some point in our history, right? Where it was perfectly brewed at 2.5%.
Right.
You know,
it can taste good, but it doesn't get me drunk, so I don't want to spend money on it.
Yeah. Right.
We did one. We had a local company, and there was a German guy that worked there. His family had a brewery in Germany, and they had this style called Leichtweisse, which is just a super light, like 2.5-3%, almost like a Dunkelweiss, but just super light.
Okay.
And they drink it there all the time. It's their Gatorade. In fact, the brand he told me about was called Sports Friends, which means sports friends.
Interesting. I love this.
Only in Germany is the beer a sports drink.
I would much rather that than a sugary bomb Gatorade, you know?
That's how they carb load before a triathlon.
Yeah.
Just chug a bunch of beer.
Yeah. We did a pilot batch with it, and people loved it. They're like, I wouldn't pay for it.
Yeah.
Just because the TV was so low. So.
Yeah, sure. We love to do a Berliner Weiss, and we haven't been able to fit it in this summer. Summer's almost gotten away from us, but... Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's 3.3%, and then we do syrups in it. We do the Woodruff and the raspberry, and it's like, it's awesome, but it's not. It's hardly even beer. It's so light.
And do you find that people also just do the same thing where they'll say to you, "Yeah, I like that, but if I'm gonna spend $6, I want a 7% beer or whatever."
Yeah, we don't charge a lot of money for it. And it's not extremely popular, except for the people who are like, they love a sour. That'll be our like on tap sour. So
sure.
Yeah,
But I mean, the brewery folks, like, we drink it all anyway, so
right.
We probably drink a quarter of the beer.
Sure. Well, and like the farmhouse style, traditionally, my understanding was that it was literally like a farmhouse beer, and it was given to farmhands like in the middle of the day. It wasn't like an end of the day beer, even. It was like lunchtime beer,
because
it would have been like a 3% beer. You have a couple farmhouse. It was cheap to make. Mm-hmm. You give it to your field hands in the middle of the day, like in France, obviously, and then move on about the rest of the day because you're not hammered.
Yeah, stay hydrated.
Yeah, exactly.
It's more hydrating
than anything.
Right.
Yeah. Well, anyway.
The good old days.
The good old days, yeah. Okay, and then before the break, we got one more beer in our glass, too. It's your, is it Centade Pale Ale?
You got it.
Okay, all right. Tell us about this beer.
Super classic hopping on a pale ale, right? Just Cascade Centennial for hopping. Easy bitterness for what would be an IPA. It'll touch more for... It'd be like the top end of what a pale ale would be. but just super easy drinking.
Yeah.
Pretty light. We took the terminal gravity down a bit on this. I wanted to make sure that it was crisp and clean and everything for sort of the hot end of summer. So
where did that finish out at?
Let me see if I can remember this one. I think it was like 10:04 about.
Wow.
Yeah, it's bone dry.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's nice and dry.
Which is great for those sea hops too, because I just love them no matter what. And then I think that in a light pail like this, if those shine, which I think they do, the dryness helps for that.
Yeah, it really accentuates the grapefruit.
Yeah.
From those two sea hops.
Yeah.
They definitely taste as advertised, Centennial and Cascade.
Yeah. Thank you for that.
In a good way.
And the aroma. And right, you know right off the bat too, just the aroma. Mm-hmm. Just a nice choice. I like a good simple pale ale, you know.
Especially when it's 100 degrees outside. A few people were just commenting about there not being enough pale ales around on Facebook. And one of them was Mitch Steele on Facebook. And so I was like, you know, I should do one, but make it just a little hoppier because that's kind of what the market wants.
I can't wait for that style to be in style again. I mean, it'll always it happens to every one of them. It'll be back, and I can't wait.
Exactly.
And then also a light golden color. Maybe we should talk about the malt bill, too, not just the hops, if you're able to get it that dry, and it is a pretty nice light SRM.
So in order just to get it as dark as I wanted it, it's actually a lot of Munich malt and a lot of Great Western's High Collar Pale.
Okay.
And then threw some unmalted grains in there to kind of keep the body around.
Got it. Yeah, it's like in between a yellow and an amber. You know, it's not it's not a fizzy yellow color, and it's not an amber. It's like kind of right in there somewhere.
Yeah, upper single digits, I would guess 5 to 7 SRM.
Okay.
Maybe.
Yeah.
It's about there. Kind of the bottom end of where, you know, bottom to mid of where a pale ale would lie. But with the Munich, it gets a nice little orangey hue to it. That's like kind of the deceiving part with the SRM numbers is you can have different hues, but the same number.
Sure.
Right. Yeah.
That makes sense. Yeah, and it's 4.9% is what you have listed here, too. It's nice. Where's JP? He's going to miss out on on these good beers that
he always misses the good shows.
Yeah, exactly.
What an asshole.
Yeah.
That beer officially does release in the tasting room on Saturday. So
it's not out yet.
We're getting a preview. Sweet.
Excellent. That's this Saturday. For those of you who might be listening to the podcast a little late, that would be August 17th. And releasing in the tasting room there in Livermore. If you want information, you can go to 8bridgesbrewing.com. You can either use the word or the number 8, 8bridgesbrewing.com, and read all about them, find out how to get there, and see all the hours of the tasting room. So about how much of your beer do you sell out of the tasting room, you think, Justin?
By volume, it's about half.
About half. That's great. Good for you.
Yeah.
Nice. Easier on your checkbook, your bank account.
And we like to connect with our customers directly. You know, it's the best way to kind of get feedback.
Sure. Okay. I'm going to take a quick break so we can get another couple beers in our glass. And then we'll learn more about 8 Bridges beer and also about the community engagement that you guys do, because I want to talk about that too. Is that cool with you, Justin?
Sounds good to me.
Excellent. We will be right back after these words. We'll be right back.
this is Matt Brennelson from Firestone Walker Brewing Company, and you're listening to The Session on the Brewing Network.
Yes, sir. Don't forget, you can try our Grenadier Pale Ale that we brewed with Matt and the Firestone people. If you can find it on the shelf, it's in their current mixed treasure pack. And our beer with our hop grenade right there on the label is the treasure beer. It's our Pale 31 recreation.
It is a treasure.
Which, yes, I'm excited. I haven't tried it yet, actually. I'm very excited.
I'm sure it's a treasure because they had batches to fix what we did.
Yeah,
we
like they blended us out of it, right. Essentially, is what they did. Justin, you must have had Pale 31 in your pale ale history.
I have had a couple of those.
Yeah. Always our favorite over here. So another C-Hop beer, too, by the way. Oh, probably why. Okay. So tell me a little bit. I read in my notes that, and maybe I shouldn't do this, you're going to get bombarded, but you had kind of said you hardly ever say no to a local charity in your tap room when they want to come to an event with you. Tell me about that.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I mean, that's our biggest thing. Like, we always feel it's important to give back to the community that helping us out. So
sure.
When it comes to local charities, we try to keep as much local as we can.
I like it.
You know, and it's, I mean, it's anything from just making sure they have something for a silent auction or something like that. Like, there's one that we do every year where we give them the ability to auction off renaming a beer after their dog for the Valley Humane Society. And that was, I mean, we had one year they called us asking if we would do two because the person who got outbid offered to match the winning bid to do another one. And it was a couple thousand dollars. So, I mean, it was.
Really?
Wow.
That's fabulous.
Numbers, but.
That is great.
And we do events in the tasting room. You know, we always tell everybody, like, if you want one of the days we normally have music or something like that, if you want to pair up for that, that's going to be the best time because we are already going to have more customers.
Right.
And then if they advertise it and do everything right, they'll get more percentage of our sales plus, you know, whatever they can collect and however they want to do it is up to them, whether they do raffles or that. So,
so
we try to support as much as we can.
That's always my thing, and I like supporting local community. In fact, here in Concord, we have saved several programs. Our Spring Brews Festival now used to be Winter Brews. That money all stays local and does programs in the park right here and helps with the 4th of July parade. And almost anything having to do with music is where we get involved. But I bring... I guess what I'm getting at is we often are approached by charities as well. And the only issue I have is when they don't help themselves, they don't help us help them. So kind of like you just mentioned, Justin, like if you're already going to have a good night and then they do some promotion, they're going to do even better. And we ended up having a little stricter kind of sign-up sheet because we were just getting folks who were like, well, look at how busy the Hop Grenade is. Let's just go do an event. And then didn't do like an ounce of their own promotion, which to me, you know, didn't help even spread the word about what they do. I feel like every charity, it's not just about raising money, but it's about raising awareness of your mission.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I'm only bringing this up because to more to those of you who might be involved with a local charity, these things are important to help us help you. You can't just sit back and do nothing because then I just feel like, well, shit, I'll just write you a check for $200 if that, you know, that's all you're going to make that night anyway.
Yep.
And you're not going to get any awareness out of it. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
Push them to a different day. We'll save our popular days for the charities that have a history of.
Right.
Repping themselves a little bit better and getting the word out. So.
Yeah, yeah. And like I said, I think it's great that you do that, and we like to do it as well. I just, if you're involved in a charity and you're going to go to your local business, just help us help you, too. That's all. Help us do that. Well, that's cool that you guys do that. You have any specific ones that do really well for you guys?
Our big one, the next one that's coming up is growing and growing even more, and that's, I want to say it's August 24th, so not this Saturday, but the next Saturday, we're doing one. It's a charity out of Livermore, and they go to helping out police canines.
Oh, nice. Like retired?
When they go to retire or when they get injured in the line of duty, that sort of thing.
Oh, that's awesome.
So we're going to have just it looks like it's going to completely take over our parking lot. We're going to have a bunch of canine units.
Wow.
Other things going on out there. So that'll be fun. And then I think one of my most favorite every year is probably our chili cook-off that we do in the first part of November. It's completely charity. Like, you don't have to pay to get in. You show up with a crock pot of, you know, your best chili, and then it's people's choice. So whoever wants to come in and taste, they have to either donate at least one can of food or throw a dollar in the jar so we can go buy more. And so we take that, they get to taste and vote, and then we crown the winner each year, which is just a repurposed Burger King crown.
Nice. yeah, that's cool.
And they get a gift card for winning it. So we do that one, and that one brings a lot of people, and it's a lot of fun. And I haven't officially weighed how much food we get, but gotta believe it's a couple hundred pounds.
Wow.
Right before Thanksgiving.
Nice.
A big time for the Alameda County Food Bank. So
that's great.
We'd like to do that and help out with them, and that's kind of fun to just have a place full of happy people with chili.
Have you won the chili competition?
Yeah, have you entered in one yourself?
You know, I did do the first one, but I kept myself from being able to win it because, you know, people might think it was rigged. But I have won chili cook-offs before.
Oh.
Very nice.
So you gave yourself a handicap then.
Yeah.
I felt it might be a little unfair that one of the owners, you know, won. although, who knows, but.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Well, go to, like I said before the break, too, you can go to 8bridgesbrewing.com if you're looking for information about their events and the things that we're talking about here, if you want to go attend and get involved in a chili cook-off and all that. So you can go to 8bridges.com. Okay. We got a couple stouts in our glass. And the first one, I believe, is named after you.
It is, yeah. That was, I want to say it was Julie Nichols was in there, and I had made this stout, and I had no idea what the heck I was going to call it. You know, I was a paramedic before, so I was coming up with all sorts of really disgusting-sounding medical names.
Mm-hmm.
They were like, yeah, maybe we shouldn't call a stout Meconium. she said, well, why don't you just put an O apostrophe in front of it, and then your name's Irish, so.
Oh, Beardsley's.
That's what we did. And the first St. Patrick's Day we were open, and I had at least a half a dozen people come up and said, if we quit making it, they'd stop coming.
Oh, wow. You know, stout fans are some of the most diehard.
Yes.
You know, IPA fans are fickle, and they just want every IPA, and it's almost everybody is an IPA fan.
Yeah.
But I have found that stout fans, I've heard that before, they'll turn on their brewery if you stop making it.
They're few and far between, but they are live and die.
Yeah, yeah.
By the beer.
Yeah, yeah.
We even, like, segment our board by, like, light beers, hoppy beers, and dark beers.
Okay.
And if there's nothing in that dark beer category, there's definitely people that are, like, a little up in arms.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so the O'Beardsley Stout, it's in our glass. It's a great-tasting stout. Was this one of your homebrew recipes that you had before the brewery, too?
No, this was the first time that I just sort of whipped a recipe together in about 20 minutes.
Okay.
And, did a pilot batch of it, tasted it when it was done fermenting, but before it was even carbonated, and like, yep, this is good. I don't want to change anything.
Yeah, I don't think you should either.
And ran with it. So, and it's an American style, so it's got some chocolate malt in it, along with the black malt, just a little bit of crystal in there for some background sweetness.
Okay.
Still let it out enough so it's not super thick, and you know, that's what it is. We have a nitro version on at the tasting room, but that doesn't go into crowlers too well. So
I bet, yeah.
I would have set that up.
And American hops or English hops?
English hops.
English hops, yeah.
Bitter with American, because why pay import fees on hops that are just fine for bittering?
Yeah. So, you know, it has a familiarity to it that I was kind of trying to, where have I tasted this before? Because I've not had this beer before. And it's a little like a Guinness to me, actually, but with the chocolate's just a little more pronounced. There's a little coffee that's more pronounced, but the kind of the subtle balance to it, where it has no real harsh edges.
Yeah.
This reminds me of like a good old solid Guinness with just a little more oomph, I guess, is what I'm getting at.
To me, it's...
And that's true. I'm using like roast barley versus black malt. Yeah. Rose barley's definitely got more astringency to it.
Maybe more like an export Guinness, like when we had them on the show and we just used the stronger one. Because this has a bit more body than just the Guinness draft.
Yeah.
But you're right on the money with the balance. The everything. Balance. It's really nice and chocolatey and coffee-like, which bumps into the American style. But, yeah, even on a day like today where it's over 100, I could see myself drinking this beer.
It's a refreshing beer.
Yeah.
It's not cloying. It doesn't stick around.
Which is great.
Yeah, it makes it like, see, I like when people are like, oh, you can never have a dark beer when it's 100, like it's 100 degrees outside right now.
Yeah.
No, full pint of this. Be fine.
Easy.
You know. 6%, which is even higher than it tastes like, I think. I think it tastes nice and low and mild. I guess anywhere in the five to six, you're not going to notice it anyway. But
I didn't send any double IPAs up, but you'd notice that in most of our beers. Like, they don't taste boozy even as the ABV goes up.
Okay.
With the exception. The barrel aged stout, just because that was sitting in bourbon barrels, so from that.
And that's the one we have next, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So what is this? This is a barrel aged, like a Russian Imperial stout?
It's a Russian Imperial. So, and it's based off of the not the first homebrew award, but the first homebrew competition I sent beer to was this recipe, unbarrel aged, and I took best of show.
Oh, nice.
Nice.
I kept running with it. But then thought, this would be pretty good if it had parked in the barrel for a while.
So what kind of barrel did this go into?
So this one we get from Sutherland Distilling. We get their bourbon barrels or their rye barrels.
Oh, nice.
So this one, a blend of, once used by us bourbon barrels, new to us bourbon barrels, and one new to us rye barrel.
Mm. Oh, so you're even using second fill to you.
Yeah, I like the balance is a little better. It cuts on the booziness just a little bit, but then you get more oak out of it instead of all that, whiskey flavor.
Yeah.
I mean, because when we then, I dumped them, and I got, almost 2 liters of liquor out of it.
So
there are.
There's a boozy barrel
underneath there.
You didn't dump it. You just put it in a different container.
That went to my bachelor party.
Okay, yeah, good. Yeah. There we go. Beardy knew.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I was going to mention that there's a strong tannin oak flavor in these. How long did they sit in the barrels?
6 months.
6 months, okay.
Wow.
And then...
What we have is 2018, so it's already past a year old since we brewed it.
So what I'm tasting is about 6 months in the barrels and about 6 months on stainless.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Exactly. Yeah. And so you now on this one, and like you had just mentioned when we were talking about the other stout, this one you can taste a little bit of the booze in. Mm-hmm. But again, I think it's pretty balanced overall.
Yeah.
And I like the mix that you did with the rye and the just regular oak. Is that rye and bourbon, I guess?
Of rye whiskey. And
rye whiskey bourbon. And then just bourbon whiskey. Okay.
Do you have any idea how old those whiskeys are when they pull them out of the barrel?
Yeah, so the rye barrel was 2 or 3 years, and I believe it was the same on the bourbon.
Because that's one thing that I'm really intrigued by is with the mass, the big guys, you're typically getting barrels that have had the whiskey in there a lot longer than that.
Hmm.
Sometimes even double or triple that amount of time, and so it's going to taste differently. And so I don't know that I've had a bourbon barrel-aged beer out of a young bourbon barrel.
Okay.
And so you definitely get a bit different flavors out of that.
But I wouldn't call... Would you call this beer boozy? I wouldn't call it a boozy beer, per se.
No, but I think the ratio of wood sugars to wood tannins is different.
I see.
Yeah. So I think I get a lot more wood tannin out of this than I would wood sugars with the bourbon being in there longer.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah, but the other thing, too, is like the Jack Daniel's barrels versus and some of the other larger producers, the oaks there. They want to keep those barrels, the barrel cost down for the oak oil there. And the barrels that we get from Sutherland are just so much thicker and so much high quality and a little bit better control on the charring and everything. So,
okay.
Definitely a more consistent barrel.
Yeah, it's a good beer. And then, it's showing its age in just the right way. I feel like some of the, it might have been, I'd be curious what it tasted like 6 months or a year ago, right when it was made. That maybe it had some sharper edges that's now kind of settling into itself. Sorry?
Previous years. But I do have a library of previous years, so I may just have to come up there and do a tasting with you guys.
This is an annual release.
There we go.
That's very cool. Yeah, it's I've always found, like, spirit barrels, you know, at points when you taste them, it's beer and it's barrel. And it's beer and it's barrel. And they are totally not together. And it's really weird.
Yeah.
I mean, in my mind, like, what is the magic that happens?
Right.
You know, it's going to be a lifetime of trying to figure that out.
And it's probably going to change every time, too.
Based on the barrel, yeah. It's different. You know, you were talking about these are relatively young bourbon barrels. Like, we have a distiller in town, and we got barrels from him, and his bourbon barrel age Russian Imperial Stout we did versus Heaven Hill barrels, like, totally different beers.
Wow.
And I know on the spirit side, go ahead.
The temperature in the barrel room makes a huge difference too.
Yes.
Temperature
and humidity. And I know
how the shift affects the whiskey, and it does it to the beer too.
Yeah.
And that's not because fermentation is happening. Is that because of how the beer, the liquid sort of goes in and out of the barrel?
Yeah, that's it exactly. The pores in the wood opening and closing, so the beer is kind of moving in and out.
And so if you have,
down it goes out.
So if you have seasons wherever these are being stored, right, where the temperature in your warehouse or brewery actually changes, then that's different than having a consistent temperature where the beer might not move in and out of the pores.
Right. It's like a winery where they're just trying to keep those barrels at the same temperature the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
The whiskey just still cycles.
Got it.
And I know some of the smaller whiskey guys actually only sample and bottle during a couple of the seasons of the year, because during the rest of the time, the barrels don't taste their best.
Oh.
And so they'll only either, I forget which one it is, I think it's typically they'll do it in the summertime, because when it's cooler and the wood closes up and things just change. And so they'll only package during a specific, or they'll only remove spirit out of the barrel at a specific range of months.
They don't want to go throwing away a barrel that might be perfectly good because it just wasn't at its peak.
Right, exactly.
Okay. That's interesting.
So I've never heard of a brewery doing that, but maybe they should consider it.
Yeah. Well, because it'd be interesting to know if you watched
You
know, I think brewers often are like, well, it didn't taste good this month, but it did taste good a few months later, but maybe aren't marking do they always taste better in June or whatever?
Yeah. See if it's a seasonal thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Notes. That's what I always say. Mm-hmm. Even if you make a mistake, write it down because it might taste good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All the info otherwise, you possibly can.
Yeah. If you don't take good notes, you can't see patterns.
Well, and do you use nails in your barrels, Vinny nails, to do sampling?
For samples, no. I just will pull the bung and pull a sample from the top.
So I'm only mentioning this because it's kind of changed our lives at the brewery right now, because we have a fair amount of barrels going, and we got some of those stainless steel nails, Vinny Truluzzo nails, it's amazing, because then it's so easy to taste all the beers. It's trouble-free.
Yeah.
I really recommend it.
And there was, like, no magic to it, right? Just nail a nail in. And
you can do it to barrels that are already full. You just
pre-drill.
You just drill, and then put the nail.
You do have to pre-drill.
You can crack a stave if you just pound a nail in.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I'm glad you guys
definitely
said that, because I always just assume you just nail that sucker in.
No, that dry wood, you got to pre-drill, make some room.
No, my barrel guy is Adam. He's in heaven. He's just like, hey, come with me. We're gonna taste all the beer.
Did he not believe you? Was he skeptical at first when you came back and said, listen, we're gonna try this nail thing?
No, I'm pretty sure he found out about it and he was like, we need to do this. And
I see.
Like,
okay,
make it happen.
Yeah, yeah.
Make it so.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a cool way to go.
Be doing that.
Sorry?
If I had more barrels, you know, that I was having to sample on a given day, like, I would definitely do that method.
Well, we only have like maybe 20 barrels right now.
Mm-hmm.
So still
makes life
I'm
easy.
Like,
yeah.
Still have to proselytize a little bit.
Sure.
That's all.
Yeah. I think in every business, but I think anytime something changes your life, like in a brewer's world, you got to share that info. Even if it's something that everyone's heard of, but they didn't really switch to it yet. I'll do that too, where I'm like a late bloomer and I'm like, listen, I know you've heard about this before. But I'm telling you, I also was a late bloomer, yeah. and it changed my world.
10 years yeah. later, it changed my life.
Yeah.
I walked into a brewery and saw they were using a piece of Unistrut to hold all their tri-clamps. And I looked at it, and I'm like, how did I not think of this before?
Yeah.
What is,
you know, everything in
sorry, what is the thing. Unistrut? I don't know what that is.
So like, that would be like right the now. Metal brackets you put on walls to hold like conduit and water pipes and things on the wall.
Oh, okay.
U-shaped with a, you know, just fits all the little brackets and pipe straps on them.
Yeah, so you can yeah. like if you go to a brand new brewery, usually yep. like Vinny's Brewery, you were there.
Uh-huh.
All of that wiring that's running through his entire brewery is on
the spine,
this, on the Unistrut.
The spine is, yeah,
got it. Okay,
Unistrut.
Yeah,
yes.
And by the way, they use it in broadcast studios too. Now that radio stations are clusters, and you have like 6 studios in one building, Unistrut going to all of them. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So.
Yeah. Many uses that stuff.
Yeah. You know, and now that we're thinking of things that are just in a brewery and changing your life, I recorded a couple Brew Strong episodes today with Jamil. Jamil's back on the show. And he mentioned something he likes to call the critical brick. And now he likes to go around and ask brewers, what's your critical brick? And they always look at him like he's crazy until he explains it. And then they all go, oh, yeah, yeah, I'll tell you. Critical brick is like he's found that every brewery has like either a brick or a piece of wire or a hook or a piece of tape that like it has one function, like whether it's holding this one hose that has no other way that it could be yeah. held or holding something up or holding something down. And it's like no other device that you can buy off the shelf will do the thing that this thing does in your brewery.
Yeah.
And he's found that every brewery has a critical brick, this random piece of something that they can't brew without it. It holds something together.
Yep. Everyone's got one.
Yeah. I found that he was doing a top 10 list of brewing equipment that he can't live without, and his number 11 was the critical brick. Whatever okay. that is, everybody it's different for each of you.
Yeah,
homebrewers all have them too. You
oh,
know,
totally.
Like mine was duct tape on a you know that always caught fire.
The duct tape caught fire. Yeah. That's a hot fire.
Yeah, I'm good at things like that.
Some kind of spring clamp when I was homebrewing to hold hoses in place or. Something like that.
Yeah, he was even talking, yeah, like a binder clamp. He would say he's been to a brewery that had a binder clamp. He's been to another one that just had a piece of baling wire. He yeah. literally got the name by a brewery that had this brick, and the brick was just the right weight and just the right shape to do whatever its function was. I think it was probably holding a hose somewhere, and that's where he even got the name from, but... Anyway, I thought that was... I think every brewer, if they think about it, they're like, oh, yeah, yeah. I've got that thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, broom handle with, like, a screw on the end.
Yeah.
Of the different, like, things that we have, it's hard to pinpoint it to one, like, could I not live without it?
Right. You've got well, a few.
And Justin, I'm sure you can jive with this opinion, but, like, when you start the brewery, it's like anything you could implement before the doors were opened, like... The possibilities, they weren't endless, but there was a lot of possibilities. And all of a sudden, you open the doors, and it's like, oh, yeah, we were going to do this one thing, but then now we make beer, and we have to keep making beer.
Yeah. And now you need it.
Yeah. Do you have any of those things that were like, you would have loved to implement them, but now, like, it's just, you're just too dang busy to do it?
Sloped floors in my...
Slope floors.
It's not
those are
cool,
key.
But you got to screw everything up, and you know we're pretty quick at it. But
yeah,
I do. I would really love the ability just to like spray things down and not have to worry about it.
Right,
man.
Yeah, Mike.
That's my claim to fame. That's my only claim to fame. Honestly.
Is that you got slope floors? Yeah,
I have some severely sloped floors.
Oh, yeah,
although great. It makes driving the forklift really interesting.
Oh, but like 7.
They can
but
be
yeah.
too sloped.
Yeah, I mean, you might have some really good things going, but I do have sloped floors, so.
I think
now I feel like I'm just bragging.
Well,
sorry, Justin.
No, you're good. I was gonna say I think there's been more than one brewer in here, and Vinny, I'm sure, was one of them I might have asked, hey, what's your one piece of advice if you're opening a brewery? And I think more than one of them have said, floors.
Right.
Like,
floors
just do the floor. Yeah.
Yep.
And almost anything else, you'll figure it out. But you can't, once you're there, you can't fuck with those floors.
Yeah. And my critical brick for the brewery was a hook to pull the drain covers.
Ah, there you go.
Oh.
Because for some reason, those drain covers had the thickest rubber grommet to hold them down. So there was no way by hand you could reach down in there and pull it up. It would
and there's no tool
up.
That they make for it, so you
exactly.
had to have a, yeah.
I had to get a specific, as thick of a metal rod as I could, and then just bend it myself into
right.
a
yeah.
J.
Critical
so
break.
So then I could just pry up on those things hard enough.
Yeah. Well, and even, you know, even if it was accessible, it's still like when you need to do it, it's when your brewery is under 4 feet of sludge.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It's not like, it's not... In a sunny day, you know,
yeah.
it's when shit has gone wrong.
You don't have time to order one.
Justin, I believe in you. One day you're going to have slope floors.
I hope so.
Or at least be able to hire somebody who can just squeegee that stuff for you.
Yeah.
My dad and I did all the construction in the place. We had some friends help us with the demo. And
oh, nice.
Oh, nice.
For the electrical, so. Yeah, no, I'm definitely looking forward to just paying somebody to do it.
Yeah, yeah. All right, Justin. Well, thank you so much for being on the show and sharing your beer with us, man. I appreciate it. Folks, like I said, you can go to 8bridgesbrewing.com and learn more about the beers, what's on tap in the tasting room, different news and events, everything that they do there. And go give Justin and his family, the whole family-owned brewery, some love out there in Livermore, California. Thanks again, Justin. I appreciate you so much.
Of course. Have a good one.
Okay, you too. Take care.
Thanks, Justin.
Bye-bye. There you go. Justin Beardsley.
Great last name.
Yeah. And a nice guy making some good stout for sure. Enjoying these beers. Still got my Russian Imperial here going.
And two of my favorite hops in that pale ale.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
That was
I'm a centennial fanatic.
Good stuff. All right. Well, before we go to the break, don't forget about Beersmith, the Beersmith brewing software. You can go to beersmith.com and check it out. And Brad Smith over there just does a great job. He's got a podcast as well where he does a really good job. Video podcast, too. And the Beersmith brewing software, you get your free 21-day trial, as always. So if you haven't taken my word for it yet, you should do that. Go check it out. It's not going to cost you anything. You're going to love it, and you're going to then buy the software. So just be warned. Go to beersmith.com and check it out. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we've got a little bit of beer news to do. I found some interesting stuff in the beer news today.
Oh, boy.
And we'll find out the winner of our Twitter game, which is to invent a BN vacation for us, right?
There are some great ideas. I want to go on them already.
Okay. Hang in there. It's the session. We'll be right back. program too and sending us their beer. It was a good time. It was fun. Okay. Hey, have you tried the new Spark Ale from 21st Amendment yet, Beardy?
Yes, Sully brought it into the studio, remember?
That's right. The Sparkling Rosé is 21st Amendment's new favorite, and it's essentially a hybrid between a cider and a beer. And they brew it with apple cider juice and grain-based sugar. Then they back sweeten it with peach, cranberry, and cherry juice. It's not really a cider, but it sure tastes like one. It's going to be the perfect beer for summer and beyond, and it's gluten-reduced with less than 10 parts per million of gluten. For those who are looking for a good alternative to big malty beers, it's 5.5%, zero IBUs, and it's called Spark Ale from the 21st Amendment. Go check it out.
Yeah, if you have a yacht, mandatory drinking.
Absolutely. I agree with that. All right. Before we do the Twitter game results, I found a couple of interesting things in the beer news world today that I thought I would bring up.
Oh. Things are still happening in the beer world?
You know, every now and then.
Okay.
I check the beer news pretty often. It used to be that stuff was, you could always find cool stuff happening, like fun, interesting. And now it's a little boring.
It does seem like things slowed down.
You know?
Yeah, there was some drama a few months ago, I remember. Hopefully there'll be some more drama.
I know. It's good for us. Yeah, if there's your more drama.
Yeah. As long as it's not my drama, somebody else's drama, I'm good.
Right. Yeah. That's how we feel too, really.
Yeah.
Or at least if it's gonna be our drama, it better be goddamn entertaining. Oh, yeah. Because I'll go through some pain and drama for you folks at home.
I can laugh along with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
Well, y'all, those of you who are longtime beer fans, or if you're from Utah, you know about the beer called Polygamy Porter.
The name rings a bell.
Yeah, it's been around.
Yeah.
It's from Wasatch Brewing Company.
Okay, yep.
Wasatch, whatever, in Utah. Well, anyway, despite its best efforts, the Utah brewery was not able to convince North Carolina to allow this article calls it their polygamy-themed beer to be sold in the state.
Wow.
I don't really like the description that it's polygamy-themed.
I mean,
how can
title.
A beer even be polygamy-themed?
Yeah. It's half the title. There's no beer celebration of polygamy.
Like, polygamy-titled? Okay. Polygamy-themed, like, actually infers that there's something going on behind the beer.
Yeah.
Like, maybe at the brewery, you know, that this beer represents.
You have to be a polygamist to possess the beer.
Yeah.
And I don't think that's the case. I think it's, in my opinion, very funny tongue-in-cheek reference to their home state's history that used to allow polygamy, to be honest. Yeah. So they made a beer, it's been around for years since we've been doing the show, called Polygamy Porter. But anyhow, it is being sold in 20 other states, but it was rejected by North Carolina because polygamy is illegal.
Because they don't want those polygamous ideas to infiltrate the state.
I guess the only statement they really gave, well, they gave two statements. One is that it was rejected because polygamy was illegal. And then in July, the North Carolina ABC board sent a statement to this news agency that said, the NCABC always gives thoughtful consideration to each label and uses the criteria outlined in the statutes as the basis for every rejection or approval. They claim that according to their statutes, representing something illegal is undignified and in bad taste.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. I mean, that's fair.
Wasatch filed an appeal, hoping to argue their case and bring the beer to the state. They said that we'll do our best to make this available for those folks out in North Carolina, and they'll get to enjoy all the fantastic polygamy porter that we're making here in Utah. But they lost that appeal. They said we were optimistic it was going to go in our favor. Obviously, the commission went against us. We're a bit disappointed. We did want to have this beer out there and available.
So they couldn't even, they can't even sell it legally because they can't register the name?
Because they can't register the name, correct.
Oh, wow.
Because the name represent, according to the quote here, representing something illegal. See, actually,
but it's legal in the state that it's made.
It's not.
It's not.
It used to be. They stopped that several years ago.
I shudder to think what's going to happen to sister wife Saison.
Yeah. No, it is no longer illegal in Utah.
Oh.
But interesting. I just want to dissect the quote a little bit from the North Carolina ABC. The North Carolina ABC always gives thoughtful consideration to each label and uses the criteria outlined in the statutes as the basis for every rejection or approval. They then don't go on to cite a statute. They just go on to say representing something illegal is undignified and in bad taste. And
I thought that was a part of the statute.
Why, you know what? If I wish I had read this earlier, I would have gotten John from the Beer Law Center on with us because he is familiar with North Carolina beer law. And I would have found out is there some statute that says any name that is represents something illegal is undignified. And I would just find that odd to be in the law. Undignified and in bad taste.
I can't help but hear.
I definitely call bullshit.
I can't help but hear the word undignified pronounced with a southern accent.
Yeah, right? It's every time it happens?
Every time every you time say, it, say it. Like, that's undignified.
I was just going to say the same thing. Absolutely.
Bank. I'm pretty sure bank robber Belgian Golden Strong could make it through.
That's illegal, right?
Yeah.
But bank robbery is dignified? Yeah. The Wasatch Brewery website describes Polygamy Porter as a smooth, chocolate, easy-drinking brown porter that's more than a little bit naughty.
Well, that kind of adds the theme.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, I'm telling you, the undignified and in bad taste part bothers me. I think it's a tongue-in-cheek. It's a funny name.
I think that's my next beer name is undignified.
Yes.
Undignified in what?
And in bad taste.
In bad taste.
But we're talking about two states that are a little ashamed of their history. So,
shouldn't be judging the other one.
Right, yeah. Maybe they're trying to sweep everything under the rug.
They ought to team up on this and see if they can help each other out.
Okay.
Judging McJudgerson, North Carolina.
Yeah. I just think it's
there is never going to be a North Carolina AF.
Also, not only do I think it's a funny name, and it has really been around for a long time, this beer. It's a good beer. I've had it. I think there's a little, it's a little ballsy, a little chutzpah of the Wasatch Brewery to do it in the beginning.
Their home state,
And you go, you know what? We're going to make fun of ourselves here. We're from Utah. We're proud to be from Utah. And we're going to make fun of the fact that we were a polygamy state. Yeah.
If the Utah ABC or whatever their board is approved it, I feel like everybody else should just rubber stamp it. They're like, well, if they're okay with it.
You know what? I hadn't even thought about that.
who is more conservative than Utah?
Anyone was going to say no, it should have been Utah.
Yeah.
It's sold in 20 other states. So North Carolina, I don't know where your standards lie, but...
We do. We know.
Watch out, narwhal.
Yeah. Okay. I found this article, at least the headline, to be interesting. Actually, I found the whole thing to be interesting, but it grabbed my attention. I was like, well, God, is this going to be one that's good for the air or not? Mm-hmm. And
so you were reading it.
The headline is, just how full of white dudes is craft beer? So they went right...
Like white dudes is an ingredient in craft beer.
Yeah. I would like to point out that the white dude ratio tonight is 50-50. Here in the studio.
In the studio? Oh,
once
you're
again,
right.
We have gender
Correct.
Parity.
Yeah.
In fact, and if you count Abigail.
Actually, if you count Abby.
Oh, we're outnumbered
we
now.
Are winning.
And you know
women.
What? We are never going to hear that in our feedback.
Nope.
No one's ever going to go, oh, the Brewing Network celebrates diversity.
Yeah.
No. All they're going to say is, well, yeah, but you don't let Teresa talk enough or
baloney.
Whatever it's going to be.
Yeah. Baloney.
Get Abby a mic. Let's go.
Yeah.
No, it's cool.
She's like, no, I'm taking a nap.
She's Come fine. On. She's actually laying on the floor.
I know. I was like, she must be on the floor.
Well, they went for the attention grabbing headline, but you know what? The content's pretty good. And as it turns out, the Brewers Association, of course, the trade group that represents craft beer, hired its first diversity ambassador, PhD, Dr. Nicole Jackson Beckham. And... She was tasked with speaking on best practices for diversifying both customer bases and staff and listening to current challenges in this area. Now, I want to point out the article kind of starts out a little strange to me because, here we go. The article starts out, it's one of the most tired cliches out there, that brewers are white, bearded dudes with pot bellies who wear flannel and turn their noses up at your regular beer.
I resent a few of those.
Beardy is totally not wearing flannel.
And also, right. They wear cargo pants or cargo shorts, not flannel.
I would have gone with cargo shorts as well.
Flannel shirts.
I don't own a pair of cargo shorts.
The author says the latter point is definitely not true, that they turn up their noses at regular beer. And I think that's accurate. They don't do sure. Brewers don't do that. But the rest of the cartoon, the dude, the beard, the unbearable whiteness of being, she says, like most cliches, there's more than a grain of truth in it. Craft brewers are overwhelmingly white dudes. And now we have the numbers to prove it. So essentially, the Brewers Association, as I mentioned, hired a PhD, joined the diversity committee, and they wanted to do a survey to find out what kind of diversity there was in craft beer. Their chief economist, Bart Watson, the Brewers Association's chief economist, Bart Watson, said that you can't really measure future change unless you know where you are to begin with. So they set out to conduct a survey and figure out what our benchmark is, where we are now. And, the findings were interesting, if not unsurprising.
Both?
Beardy.
Yes.
On a percentage scale.
Okay.
What would you say the percentage of Brewers Association member breweries reported employing a woman with the job title of brewer? About what percent you think female brewers just they said the job. This is apparently how the question was posed, so they didn't have to be a head brewer or an assistant brewer. It was just member of breweries who reported employing a woman with the job title of brewer.
I would guess, gosh, 11%.
A little high. I already went over this off air with Teresa. She doesn't get to play along. 7.5% of member breweries reported employing a woman with the job title brewer. Though, women were more represented among non-brewing staff.
Sure.
37% of breweries reported employing a woman in a non-production, i.e. brewing, non-service, i.e. taproom servers, position.
Yeah.
So administrative, marketing,
sales,
you name it, sales, sure.
Those things, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I definitely would have guessed higher for those positions.
Because it seems like it's changing, right? And I might have guessed higher too. Teresa, were you surprised at the 7.5% number at all?
Or is No, not really. I'm even thinking of the people I know in Sacramento, and it's probably around. That's probably par for the course, and even in Sacramento.
Just that, or maybe about 7%. Yeah, your head brewer is female as well, right?
Exactly.
Is your title brewmaster? Is that
so?
What you have?
I'm the brewmaster. Yeah. I have a head woman head brewer.
Yeah.
Happens to be the youngest head brewer in the Sacramento area.
Ah.
Her name is Alyssa. She's amazing. And then we have three other gentlemen who work in the brewery. So I realize we just disrupted our 50-50 split. But, I embrace diversity, but I feel like I've never hired for specifically for diversity's sake.
Yeah.
You know, Alyssa is just someone who I tried to hire, and then she went to work for a bigger brewery, and then it kind of went sideways, and she was looking for a place to come, and I was like, you know, now we're ready. We're ready to have a head brewer. This is like perfect timing. So,
sure.
She's just a fantastic individual, but I still feel like the future is bright. You know, I'm tapped into the Pink Boots. I read through their Facebook group, and there's always someone who's like, you wouldn't believe what happened in the brewery. And there'll be this like total disaster of like misogynistic behavior, or somebody is like limiting the motivation of females in the brewery and all this stuff. And I'm like, I'm so glad that our brewery isn't like that. Yeah. And I have good hopes for the future.
Yep.
I think the tide is turning and it's gonna change.
At Lomo is 50% male and female.
On the brew team?
Yeah.
Because it was you and one other?
Yes, right.
Female brewer.
Yeah. It was easy to get to 50%.
Yeah.
And you hired that other brewer.
Yes.
And I'm going to go out on a limb here and say, like Teresa, you didn't hire her for diversity. You hired her for, she was the right person for the job at the time? Or you hired her for diversity?
No.
Or you were hitting on her?
It had nothing to do with diversity. She wanted, she was on the marketing sales side in the beer industry, mm-hmm. wanted to get into production, was a home brewer. And because Jamel was so nice to me years back, I was like, I need to pay this forward now and bring someone into the fold. And she just killed it. So, nice. Yeah.
Okay.
Now she's running the place.
Now, even though, and I'll go through a little bit more of the study here, too. Even though the Brewers Association is sort of trying to find out what our baseline here is and then see if they can develop, like, best practices to encourage diversity, I'm going to guess that most workplace experiences are going to be like you both described, and that the people aren't going to go necessarily out of their way to hire an unqualified female,
right,
or an unqualified black brewer. You know, you it might be nice if all things are equal and you're looking to have a little more diversity in your workforce. You might then pick based on those things, but I think mostly you're just going to pick a qualified person.
I also didn't have to place an ad at all. Mm. She actually right got there. Offered a management position. Mm-hmm. And turned it down to get into the brewery.
Got it. So you're
so
not
it
an equal
job
you,
ad.
So you weren't an equal opportunity employer.
Well, I was actually a no opportunity employer until I hired her.
I'm fairly certain that's illegal.
You were like, I'm making this opportunity for you.
I'm just going to amend this podcast and say that Beardy actually did post an ad somewhere for at least 5 minutes.
I forgot about that.
totally.
Pretty sure it's required.
I applied.
Really?
There he said no.
Right.
He's like, you're not good enough.
I offered that for them to hire me twice, but they said no.
What else is here? The numbers on racial diversity in the industry are even less encouraging, says the author of this article. Just 1% of craft brewery owners are black, and just 4% of craft brewery employees are black. Other minority groups are slightly better represented, but not by much. A full 88% of craft brewery owners are white. So there you go. That's about all of the statistics. I'm sure there was more, but that's about all that there was in this article. I wanted to point out something that Teresa and I talked about before the show, and that is that our observation, of course, we didn't conduct a study here, but our observation about beer events is that diversity is doing much, much better than maybe in the workplace of craft beer.
Oh, amongst consumers? Yeah.
Yeah.
Huge.
You know, not only do I see it at the Hop Grenade, which I can look out the window right now, but certainly at our beer festivals that we hold, larger ones I've been to. Good Lord, the Great American Beer Festival is pretty goddamn diverse if I've ever seen one.
Yeah.
And I think we bring that up because we're encouraged by that. Because that wasn't always the case. Not since I've been in this industry, by the way. That really wasn't always the case either. And I think that changing, and then hopefully it just continues to sort of change in the workplace.
And that's how it starts.
You know,
it'll transition from consumers. I mean, just like how it did with craft beer back in the 90s. People got a taste for it, then started making it on their own.
Well, and the consumers see those women and people of color and you know, participating in the industry, and they connect and they say, oh, you know, I love craft beer so much and I want to get into it. And I see you do this, so it's going to be okay. I mean, if I had this like reason in my life, like a cause celeb, like that that was my calling. Like my calling is to like tell women that beer is okay for you, and you don't have to drink chick beers, and you don't have to be in a certain box, and like you don't have to keep yourself out of making beer, and like you can do all those things. Like that's why I'm here.
Yeah,
that's the whole reason.
And I'm here to tell bearded white guys that beer is okay for you to drink.
Yeah,
because we need you.
Absolutely,
we really need you.
But nobody could be quite as bearded as you. So
yeah,
you know,
you gotta set an example.
Gotta set a goal. Beard goals.
Well, again, not only on this program right now tonight are we more than 50% diversified and, and non-white males, but one-third of our session shows done in the month of July had black brewers on them.
Wow.
Yeah.
I was kind of surprised by the 80%.
It's really because one out of our three shows had a black guest. Right.
But,
but the statistic is still true.
Hey,
but one-third of sessions.
Yes.
The ratio in that on that evening of white people in the studio versus black people in the studio
swung
in the other direction also.
Well, and that was...
No one's ever
going to
give us credit.
And it was so fun. Just, I mean, even just the family aspect. And
Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Yeah. No one is ever going to give us credit for it. We'll just always be the misogynist dick joke beer network.
Full of white people.
Full of white people. Yeah.
Hey, but they had to change it from white men to white people.
Yeah. Just for
and
us. We're changing things.
Anyone who knows me well knows that I only spit take for dick jokes. So there you go.
There we go. Perfect.
Therese will do just fine.
Yeah. He's going to keep doing just fine on this program.
I'm just trying to fit in. No, I'm not. That's for real.
Okay. That's all I have in the beer news for you. And thank you all for participating in that. Okay. But we do have a Twitter game today.
We do.
What was our Twitter game, Beardy?
It was... Looking, crowdsourcing trip ideas for the new BN travel agency that we're going to be starting.
Okay. So what did we get? Did we get some good ones here?
Oh, man. I think we're going to have to go test these out.
I can't wait.
So we got good ones. All right.
Let's see. Just rearranging. Okay. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. We have Seabass. He says, easy. Nationwide strip club tour in the RV, complete with inexplicable fire, running with the law, and Justin and JP fist fight.
There we go.
Oh, my God. I can't wait. That's so awesome.
Diversity out the window already. It took 35 seconds for us to talk about objectifying women in a strip club. And I am all for it, by the way.
It wasn't us. It was Seabass.
Yeah. I mean, I can't believe this.
Jumbo strip club in L.A. I cannot.
There we go.
Can't believe it took somebody not in that room to come up with an idea of a strip club tour in the RV.
Yeah, this is a fantastic idea, by the way. Yeah,
right.
This might actually, whether you win or not, this might just happen.
I mean,
does the winner get their idea?
Do they get to do it?
Yeah, that would be a great prize.
I do have a stack of $2 bills burning a hole in my top drawer.
You're the worst.
Brewer of Seville says, the trip begins riding bitch on the back of Dave Marliov's bike as he takes you to Alaska for a hiking trip with Warren, culminating in a cross-country trip with Justin in the BN bunker.
Wow.
Better yet, just say fuck it and stay at home.
Oh, that's a great one.
Yeah, much safer.
Yeah.
You have less chance of catching some leg disease. Lots of options there.
That is a dangerous trip, I just want to say right now. That is a high, you got to take out life insurance before going on that trip.
If your wife is also looking to get rid of you, try this package we have.
Yeah.
Let's see. What's It Face says, boner chicken on a private island in the Bahamas.
Man, we haven't had a good game of boner chicken in a long time.
Oh, my God. I forgot about that.
We're getting older, Justin.
Do I still have that song on here? I wonder if I ever programmed that into... No, I got to get that back. I got to go find
it. The new studio?
No. We haven't played that in years.
No, it's been years.
Okay. Great song. That was a really good one. Okay, go on.
Yeah. Let's see. Joshua says... Finally go on the Adam and Eve tour.
Oh, yeah.
That would be a great one.
Isn't that in North Carolina?
Oh, right. Can we go there?
Yes.
I don't think we're allowed.
Oh, to, like, tour the factory?
The warehouse.
The warehouse, yeah.
Oh. Yeah. I don't think that's as fun as you think it would be.
I agree with that. I've seen the warehouse from the outside. It looks like a warehouse.
I bet it's like going to Amazon.
Yeah, just robots, you know, moving dildos around into boxes.
Boner fulfillment center.
Yeah.
What's wrong with that?
Yeah. In the town of Boner, North Carolina.
Yeah. Like Boner Chicken in the Adam and Eve warehouse.
Yeah. There's got to be a city in America somewhere called Boner, right?
Oh, there has to be.
I'm looking it up now.
Thank you. I'm just like accidentally. Okay. What else?
And then lastly, Joe says, Alaska to retrieve Beardy's body when his wife finally kills him.
Oh.
Because oddly enough, she wants to go back to Alaska. I'm not sure why. Because we saw and did the things there.
So when you say you're going backpacking again, she just wants to go straight back there for it, not to another place.
She's okay with another place, but okay. She'd be fine just going right back there.
Wow. Yeah, because she didn't offer you yet.
Right. You know. She had some practice.
Yeah.
She's going to perfect it next time.
She did. I mean, you're a wily little fucker. God, I mean, she got you 6 miles out off a road.
Oh, back me into a corner. Look out.
She fed you berries. She did everything.
Yeah, mystery berries. Had me walking on a cliff.
Oh, my God. I still can't believe you ate the berries.
She was very confident that they were edible.
After the conversation where I told you she's killing you. Of course she's confident.
Oh, my God.
No, these are, she does that thing where, it looks like you're eating them, but you throw them back past your mouth. She's like, they're so good.
Yeah. She did all that.
And just stares at you for did you find it weird that as you were eating, she just stared at you for an hour?
She's like, you only ate five.
Are you
need
okay?
To eat six. You need to eat at least six.
How are you feeling? Are you tired from your walk?
Are your toes tingling?
Are you sleepy?
She's looking for hives. Where's the hives?
She kept pulling my sleeves up.
She's got a stethoscope out. What are you doing? Nothing. Yeah. Just practicing for nursing school.
You're not sweating as much as I thought you'd be right now.
No, bleeding from the ears or the eyes.
She's like reading under her breath. Sweating, bleeding from the gum. I don't see any of these.
Vomiting, diarrhea. No.
He ate the wrong berries.
She's like, I'm not feeling so well. I think I got this wrong.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Did you find a town in America called Boner, Beva? I'm just
curious. There's not a town that I found called Boner, but there is a whole list of lewd sounding names per state.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
I think Pennsylvania has a few.
Pennsylvania has one called Intercourse.
Oh,
it looks like
one.
Rhode Island has one called Swallow Hill.
Swallow Hill.
Oh, that's not Rhode Island. That might be Virginia.
There's
I don't know.
There's hills in Rhode Island.
There's one called Hooker in Oklahoma.
Yeah, that was a name, though. That was like a last name.
Three-way in Arizona.
Three-way.
Three-way.
Is that one word or two?
Oh, yeah,
two.
Okay. In Arizona.
Yeah.
Established 2018. Like, right. Some of these, they can't be that old.
Dick Shooter in Idaho.
Dick Shooter.
No.
One word or two. One word or two. That also could have been someone's name.
Dick Shooter
point.
Is one word.
Okay, that's not someone's
name.
Someone's
name?
Yeah, Richard Shooter.
Oh, but there is, where is this? I think it's. Is there a South Dakota? There is South Dakota.
Yeah.
The names aren't here, so I'm just doing this by sight. Sorry.
Okay.
Boner Steel is a thing.
Boner Steel.
Wow.
One word or two?
One word.
Okay.
Boner Steel.
Boner Steel, like I'm stealing a boner right now, or like stealing.
I feel like it's like a boner of steel.
This boner's so hard, yeah.
I didn't even think of that. I thought more of how are you going to steal a boner?
Oh, no, I thought steel hard boner.
I didn't even know.
Yeah.
I didn't think about that. Probably because I've never had one. I don't know what that is.
I kind of want to move to Dick Shooter just so I can have that be my address.
Yeah.
If I find
a pen pal and
also Felchville.
Feltville?
Felchville.
Yeah.
Felch?
Does Dick Shooter have a craft brewery yet? Because
ooh.
Dick Shooter Craft Brewery is also.
Dick Shooter Brewing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you heard about the new brewery in Sacramento area. I think it's Elk Grove. It's called Hungry Pecker.
No.
Come on.
Swear to God.
No.
And you know that's going to be like something else, but it's like, okay, even if it means something else, really, though? Is that what you want to call your brewery? Or they're going to be like, no, it means you have it right. Hungry Pecker.
I
think we have it right.
You do?
Isn't that the same area where they had that Special Ed Brewing?
Yeah.
Is it the same guy?
What? Yeah.
The logo was a short bus.
Oh, my God. That poor guy.
There is a beer.
He's like,
there's a beer called
like
Dick Shooter.
There is?
Oh, okay.
Okay. Okay, well, we have five finalists in our Brewing Network Dream Vacation.
Yeah.
Strip club tour in the bunker, I assume, in the RV.
I mean, to me, the bunker part is the worst part of that trip.
Although I feel like if we were going to do a strip club tour, it should be in my piece of shit RV. Like, it fits.
But we need to make money on this. Do you think we'll make money if we only sell seven tickets?
Seven. They're very expensive. Or we just make them buy all the strippers and beer, and then we don't really make money, but we don't lose it either.
I mean, yeah.
You know. Okay. The next one was riding bitch on Dave Marley of Uvu's bike on the way to Alaska. And then getting in the bunker somewhere.
Yes.
Basically, right? The most dangerous trip ever. Where'd the bunker go? Home?
You just go in a cross-country trip back from Alaska.
Got it. Okay. That was number two. Number three was boner chicken on a private island in the Bahamas. I assume that would have to be a tournament style, not just one match.
Are we talking single elimination?
It's just, what was that big fight, the Thunder Down Under, like big Muhammad Ali fight or whatever? It's just like one giant match with the two best boner chicken contestants on earth.
You will be eliminated immediately if there's a Thunder Down Under.
The Adam and Eve tour, finally take that Adam and Eve warehouse tour. And finally, what was the Alaska one?
Oh, to retrieve my body when Candy finally kills me.
That's right. A trip to Alaska to retrieve Beardy's body when Candy finally kills him. I don't know what to eliminate. I'm going to eliminate the Adam and Eve tour. I think we all agree there's nothing. That's not going to be that fun.
Yeah. Okay. It'll be a fun afternoon. It's not a trip.
I like the commentary. I like the submission.
Yes.
But not a good...
You need to flesh that one out.
Yeah.
Literally.
Stop it.
You know... A boner chicken tournament doesn't last that long. It's every contest is pretty quick.
Yeah, but you'd be in the Bahamas.
Right, but you're also in the Bahamas.
On a special island. Right.
Private island.
Private.
Do you have
island.
To be naked on this private
yeah,
island?
Yeah, because then I have to sunscreen all over. That's a whole thing.
Do you guys want to keep it in?
Or I mean, I do like the Bahamas part.
All right, we're going to take out boner chicken.
That doesn't appeal to our new... 50% demographic of women, I don't think, also.
Right. Yeah, we don't want to go and just spectate.
Oh, I do.
Oh, you do?
I just want to point and laugh.
I don't know.
Yeah. Oh,
yeah. That's what I'm good at.
That's punishment enough.
Yeah, that's
being
ridiculous.
Shamed by Bebo.
Yeah. Yeah, Bevo shaming is a new thing. It's not us shaming Bevo. You know,
right,
listeners, you must realize that Bevo shaming is actually what she does to us.
Oh, yes, absolutely,
exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
It happens off mic, and it's very scarring.
Yeah.
There's so much judgment, you have no idea.
All right, that leaves us three to vote on. Okay, so before you vote, just to recap, strip club tour in the bunker, the most dangerous vacation ever where you ride bitch on Dave's bike to Alaska and then get in the bunker. Go somewhere. And then finally, going to Alaska to retrieve Beardy's body after Candy kills him.
I would appreciate that.
We're going to start at the bottom. Raise your hand if it's going to Alaska to retrieve Beardy's body. As our, yeah.
I mean, I don't
it's not a very fun vacation.
I don't want to go on that trip.
I mean, yeah. I also just feel like if Candy works that hard, like, just let nature have him.
Let sleeping Beardy's lie.
Exactly. We'd make it back up there.
Give him back to the earth.
He would just be a pile of bones.
It's great to know you guys care.
Give him back to the earth. Well,
I don't want to carry your bloated, smelly body anywhere.
You would wait that long? You wouldn't go looking for me immediately?
We'll cut off your beard and bring that home and... But
we'll just spread every time.
Well, like, instead of your ashes, we'll spread your beard at sea.
It's probably the only thing that won't be eaten. You know what I would hope? And I mean this from the bottom of my heart.
When I die.
Because there are so many wild animals, there would be absolutely nothing left of you except a perfectly shaped beard on the ground. Like everything else like was eaten or disintegrated, but your hair, your head of hair and your beard was all just laying on the ground like it's a face, but with no face.
And then a little bird would, like, make a nest in the beard.
Oh, I love it.
Aww. And there'd be little baby chicks.
So cute, Beardy.
In the beard.
I mean, I would like to think that my beard might command a little bit of respect out in the animal kingdom. So maybe it could happen.
I don't know.
I think it would be more confusion than respect.
Okay, yeah. Nice. Hey, confusion works.
So nobody wants that one as much fun as it would be to find you that way. Okay. Riding bitch on Dave's bike. To Alaska, and then the bunker. No votes, which means strip club
unanimous.
Tour?
Unanimous.
Strip club tour. I think I see Abigail's hand up back there somewhere. Everybody thinks that's the best. That is obviously the most fitting first BN vacation.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
I think we would easily sell out.
Yeah. It makes all the sense in the world.
Yeah. So we're offering dates starting in February.
We could just do like a like a caravan of motorhomes.
Yep.
Yeah.
That
I've
way
got
we can
one.
Get more tickets.
I've yeah. got yeah. one. We could fit in a couple more there.
I feel like we
I'm
have
working
to...
on getting one.
Oh, see, there we go.
Yeah.
I have motorhome. Motorhome FOMO.
Motor FOMO.
Motor FOMO.
Yeah. Yeah. Motor FOMO.
It's better than motorboto. Mm. I also feel like if we have a caravan of RVs, we can only go to strip clubs where we can park them all in the parking lot.
Man. Oh,
so
yeah.
So that people can tell how white trash it's about to be.
Yeah.
I feel like that's going to affect our experience quality.
Yeah.
Only in a positive way.
In a good way.
Well. You should start at the strip club, like on the way to Yosemite that you pass. That's like open, but it already has its own like trailer parks on either side of it. You know what I'm talking about.
Of course,
is
I
that
do.
The,
I don't,
is that the
but
one
I'm gonna find out.
Yeah,
I'm worried that it might not still be there, but there
is that
used
the one that
to be
down?
One. I'm just about to ask.
Damn.
Oh no,
there's one north of Chico. Remember that we went by after going through Sierra Nevada?
Did we go in it?
No,
we just
kind of honked and were like, hey. Okay. And it was in a wide open space.
Oh, but it so might have gone down in the fires?
That's what I'm wondering.
Why didn't
we
fucking fundraise for that shit? I would have raised some money for
Isn't
that.
Isn't that what FEMA's for?
Yeah. Bring back the strippers.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. This one might. I like this trip. I feel like we won't even invite it. We might do this and not invite anybody because we just like being around each other and strip clubs.
So
Teresa's in.
How do you word this email to the company that actually reached out to us?
So listen. So we polled our listeners.
So we figured this out.
This is what they wanted.
I'll give them all. I was like, Boner Chicken was a close runner up.
Yeah.
But we ended up at strip club tour.
Yeah.
They're
but
gonna be like,
low airfare. Yeah. Keep prices down.
That's right. They're never going to respond. All right, that's going to do it for us today. Next week on the program, we've got the Long Beach Beer Lab in the studio, I think, hanging out with us.
In the studio.
Coming up in a couple weeks, I'm really excited. We've got an all-new New Zealand hop farm flying out here to do the show with us. And we're going to find out about they're developing the largest hop farm in the entire country. They're brand new. They're smart folks. I've been talking to brewers about them, too, actually. And people are like, oh, yeah, we've been there. We've seen their facilities. We've seen what they're doing. This is going to be a big deal. So we've got them. They're called Hop Revolution. And they are intending to do just that. Like, we all know that there are some hops in New Zealand. But they are looking to, like, revolutionize what's happening. And they're coming out here to hang out with us and do our show.
And that's in 2 weeks?
That's in 2 weeks. Next week, we got Long Beach Beer Lab and then Hop Revolution the Monday after that. So, good stuff coming up.
Yeah.
Do you have the bullshit we do at the end, or am I just getting out
of here? I don't have that pulled up.
No worries. All right, everybody. Thank you for hanging out with us. Teresa, always great to see you.
Always good to be here.
Well, so I don't even know who's here next week. You or Sully.
I'm going to arm wrestle Sully.
Okay.
I'm going to go down there and arm wrestle him and figure out who's going to be here.
You can play Boner Chicken.
Yeah. I bet. My money's
on
Teresa.
I'll get my strap on.
Lady Boners count, too. You know?
That's a thing?
That's a thing. All right, everybody. Thank you for hanging out with us. Thank you to Eight Bridges Brewing Company, Justin Beardsley, for hanging out with us today and sharing his beer. Go to eightbridgesbrewing.com and check it out. And we will see you next week right here on the Brewing Network.
Justin's a nice guy and winning the race. JP's as great as his cherry.